Don't despair, folks. Everything is going the right way. Everything is going the right way. So, as we're headed into this event horizon here, I'll be on time. I'm always on time as far as being prepared at the right moment. We will be prepared and everything will go forward the way it's supposed to go. Practice is the key. Practice is the key. Leave everything. There's a nice leaflet that reminds us of this practice. Leave everything just as it is and shift our attention to clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. Clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. Leave everything the way it is. So I was practicing this morning, this practice. Second day of practice. And suddenly, I felt like deep within my psyche, like a steel band that suddenly snapped, some very large steel band I didn't even realize was there. Suddenly it just snapped. And there was this cry of extreme consternation and anger as this steel band snapped and it fell away from me. Someone who was using that steel band to help try to control me, gain access to me, had lost their access. And they were very, just like completely shocked and stunned and just full of this disaster for them, consternation, as they seemed to fall into hell, as it were. They're falling into the pit. And this happened deep within my psyche. And I experienced it. I said, wow. Okay. But it was so deep, you know, the surface, I felt like, oh, everything's fine. It's like an earthquake deep beneath the surface. Eventually, the tsunamis, you know, will happen. Yeah, but right where the earthquake happened, maybe the ocean, you know, a little bit of, but not much. It's smoothed out because of the depth of the ocean. So this happened, and it happened because of the practice I was doing. This is the power of these practices. This practice snapped this steel band, this something that was tied to me, that gave access to that which I didn't want to give access to myself. And they had forged a steel band, thinking that it could never be broken. Well, this practice snapped it. I was talking about that yesterday in the video yesterday. The very clever fake gurus that have been here that overawed us with their esoteric mumbo jumbo that they're able to string it together in such a way that it seemed very profound, but you know, but their motives were not necessarily right. I said just full stop in the wow, be nice about it, don't just see what happens. So this is the attitude I had. I worked on graphics in the evening. I didn't really get anywhere. I said, what am I doing? Wasting my time. But no, I was just taking it easy, just coasting for a little while. I had a feeling that we were right on the cusp of something very important. And in practicing this morning, suddenly I was liberated from tremendous liberation from something that was trying, that has been causing me problems throughout my life. And they weren't pleased about it at all, but you know, they fell into the pit. I didn't hear them anymore. And this is not the first time that something like this has happened. Sudden liberation deep within my psyche from while I'm practicing. No bells, no whistles, but this consternation of something that was counting on being able to enslave me lost their hold upon me. And they were very, very, shrieked in anger and oaths, you know, just bellicose anger. Their apple cart was tipped over. So these practicing is essential. You cannot avoid it. Now, I've said this over and over and over and over and over, and have to keep repeating it ad nauseum. Because most of us are being controlled in such a way, our continuity fear is controlling us in such a way, is it tells us we don't need to practice, we're smarter than that. But what it really means is we're too afraid to practice, and so we'd rather be enslaved than practice. This is a fact. So practicing is the most difficult thing you'll ever do, simply because you're afraid of it. You think, oh, I can't do it, because the ego's told us we can't do it. We're not able to do this. And so you think you'll be terrible at it. But in fact, you won't be terrible at it, because it's so simple. You say, well, I can do this. When you do it, you say, oh, that's not difficult at all. Let's actually enjoy it. What's the ego talking about? Ego must be crazy. Well, ego is crazy. These are not difficult practices to do. Leave all disputes just as they are, and shift attention to clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. Leave all detective work just as it is, and shift this very instant into 360 degree pristine clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness this very instant. Leave everything on the table just as it is. Leave the banquet on the table just as it is. And this very instant, shift into 360-degree pristine, clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. I went into this buffet recently, and all these people were just chowing down. I mean, it was just this intense scene. So much food. All you pay a certain amount, all you can eat. And I felt like, I don't want to eat. I don't feel like eating. So I just sat there, and I didn't even have a plate. They ordered me a plate, and then I said no. So I got refunded. Money got refunded. And I just sat there. I didn't eat a thing. I just watched everybody. I was like, whoa. Just watch people eating who are in like a buffet. And you know, they're like animals. You know, just, I just like stuff in their face. I said, good Lord, you know. Wow. So we can refrain from that. We can refrain from the world. I refrain from eating. You see there. We can do it. But we just don't think about it. The ego says, no, you're here. You got to eat of the ego. You got to eat of this world. You got to eat this food. Say, no, I don't feel like eating this food. So I put a lot of pressure was put on me to eat. I refused to do it. And the people, they said, okay. You know, they didn't get too bruised. Their feelings didn't get too bruised because they were stuffing their faces. But no, that was a very important moment, because I told them I wasn't going to eat. They still took me to this buffet place, but I didn't eat. They thought they could get me to eat. They were sure they could get me to eat, and I didn't. So it must have given them some pause to think, thought, like, wow. So we just think, oh, we're in this world. Of course we have to accept the belief systems of this world and everything. What else is there? Well, we cannot accept them, except the belief system of the Holy Spirit. Speaking of the Holy Spirit, let us, this Holy Spirit has grown my family of a spiritual family of spiritual protectors, okay, and mentors, protectors, same thing. Started out with Jesus Christ, all right. Then went to Sri Sri Anandamayi, then to Ramana Maharshi, then to Longchenpa. Now, those are the four root Dharma kings. Great spiritual protectors. Now, within those various traditions, there's some helpers that are helping me out. Christianity, St. Paul and St. Jude have shown up big time. These are very, very, very great helpers of Jesus Christ. And so they've helped me out. In Tibetan Buddhism, you have Jamyang Kyentse Choki Lodro and Chandro Sering Chodron, his spiritual consort, Dakini. They've helped me out a great deal. Okay. They've been there. So that's eight, right? Eight. Number nine is Vajrayogini. And number 10 is what? The Holy Spirit. last but not least, the Holy Spirit. 10. I have 10 spiritual protectors now. Start out with none. Then I started with the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit then introduced me to, you know, Jesus said, just got to pay attention to this. Start paying attention. So I did, of course, in miracles. But it's now 10 and growing, probably growing all the time. I don't know what's next. So this is very auspicious when you have 10 spiritual protectors have your back. I absolutely recommend to everybody right now that they have spiritual protectors. And I recommend all of you to any spiritual protector that you happen, that happens to come, you come to you and you come upon it somehow. And if you can just audit, you can just say, well, let me audit this for a little while if you want to. And you could say that I sent you. If they ask you, well, you know, who sent you? Who knows what tradition or who it will be, right? But you need spiritual protection right now. As it says in the scriptures, the Holy Bible, it says during the end time period, which we are now about to enter into the event horizon of that period, that even the saints of God will be in danger of getting pulled down into concretism, I mean, losing their abstraction, getting pulled down into duality. Even the saints are in danger. I feel endangered. I need spiritual protection. I'm not a saint. I'm not a saint, but I've done a lot of work, Dharma Prince, and I feel very much endangered of being pulled down. So the more help we get, the better. I'm calling on the heavyweights for help now, for everybody, because I understand the danger that's coming, which is to loop us back into concretization, to go from non-dual back into duality. It's a trap. This world is a trap. It's a setup. And of course, it's all pretense, but it still seems very compelling, doesn't it? Because we're so good at pretending, virtually flawless at it. So you absolutely call upon the grace of God and to give you spiritual protection at this point. Now, I might have left someone out of that list. Possible. If it's true, I'll ask them to remind me, of their helpfulness. But these are all the ones I've mentioned. I've had direct experience with them, miracles from them, direct experience, direct meetings with them, talks, you know, associating. It's not book stuff. It's real mentorship. I've actually been mentored. And protected, and God knows we all need protection here. It is absolutely horrible. This world's always that way, but never more so than now. It's trickier now. It's slicker. It's more clever right now. It's before you look back and you say, oh, I could see through that. Well, seeing through these times is very difficult. Not impossible. So the idea is to take refuge from these times. Refuge in protection, refuge in the core of the Dharma King, where you practice. Now, I understand this issue of practicing very, very clearly, because previous life I was a among other things, a piano player, virtuoso piano player. And people would hear me play and they'd say, oh, wow. And they saw the crowds that came to see me and all the adulation, and I was very, very extremely well known and welcome into any court, royalty, anywhere. And I was just, you know, because of a lot of things, but people had asked me, play the piano. Anybody, the princes, kings, whatever, you know, play the piano for us. And so they'd get all the court around and I'd play the piano and I'd just, you know, blow them away because I was very, very good at it. Why? Because I received great teaching when I was young and I was taught how to practice. I was taught how to practice. So I had super good teachers that taught me how to practice. And then I was super disciplined and determined and had all the right stuff. Now, there were some other really great piano players around. And, you know, that they practiced, knew how to practice too. That's the key, is you have to know how to practice. and manage your success. So I learned how to practice and how to manage my success. And my teachers always emphasized that the basics, real simple basics, you had to know. You had to have all that just flawlessly wired within you. So, you know, just automatic, no trouble at all. There's ways that you have to practice, and you have to be very dedicated. So I was very, very dedicated, constantly playing, constantly practicing. And then, but so the people would come to me, they'd see the attention and everything, and the standing I had, and they'd say, wow, he's getting that just because he can play piano. I can do that. I got a piano. Maybe I can do that. Maybe I can get all this attention and, you know, get this pull, you know, in high society and all this kind of stuff. And so they were intrigued by they think maybe there's an easy way, you see. They were looking for some easy way to get into what they thought was happiness, the good life, which it really wasn't at all. But so they thought that they could take lessons from me. So I obliged some. I really didn't want to, because I understood, they didn't really, you know, they didn't have it, you know. But I obliged some people, but very few. I didn't really want to. I wanted to make sure they were serious. However, what they thought was that there was some secret they could learn, which would bypass the necessity for, you know, all the practice that I'd put in. That if they were just nice enough to me, I'd give them some shaktipat, you know, shaktipat. And like, oh, I've got the bliss. Now I've got the talent. They were hoping I could somehow give them the talent so they wouldn't need to practice. Now, practice is the talent that I had. That was the talent. My talent was practice and is practice. That's my talent. This is the talent that everyone is searching for and needs. And they didn't get it. They didn't get it. So I didn't have any, you know, really good students. There are a few that were pretty good, but generally those who really succeed have a great skill of practice. They don't have hardly any students at all. That because everyone's just thinking that maybe they can just give me the talent. They think there's some secret talent, and they completely overlook or don't want to see that practice is the talent. Right practice is the talent. So I run into the same situation here in this world, this time around, generally speaking, most of us, with some exceptions, think that we're just looking for some talent so that I don't have to practice. Yeah. No, that's because the ego says, well, that's beneath you, practicing. What are you talking about? You're the son of God. You don't need to practice. Okay, now let's get into this issue of practicing, because it's very important. It's very key to understand this, to recognize this. Because it's a flipping of the script situation here. People say, and the ego tells us, you don't need to practice, the son of God. Well, that's right. We don't need to practice. However, all of us are practicing like crazy. We're practicing egoic pretension and arrogance. We're practicing arrogance, actually. So we're fanatic practitioners of arrogance. So what we need to do is to practice not practicing. Now get this. As Jesus said, it's the illusion that removes all other illusions. The holy instance, the illusion that removes all other illusions. And on my mind, I would say, God uses a thorn to remove the thorn that's embedded in your flesh. Ram Maharshi says, no one succeeds without very determined perseverance and practicing. You've got to. But it's the practice that frees us from practice. We don't realize that we're practicing arrogance. So the ego doesn't tell you that. The ego says, no, you don't need to practice. What it means is you don't need to practice getting free of arrogance. Because the ego believes that more arrogance will tip the scales, and then that's the new reality. Arrogance is the new reality, which is totally false. So we do have to practice getting free of practice. This is essential. So in that practice that I did this morning, the last 2 days, of just leave everything just as it is and shift attention to clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness, just right now. Leave everything just as it is, and you can take each situation, circumstance. I came up with many, 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 many. From your dreams, you can take all these dreams that arise, just take scenarios that arise in the dreams, just say, leave that this instant just as it is. Nothing more and nothing less, just as it is, and shift your attention to clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. This, then, snap that steel band of arrogance that was attached, that had attached to me at some deep level of the psyche, that was still controlling me, thinking that I had to practice what I am, practice being. This keeps you out of abidance, actually. Abidance practice, as Longchenpa says, is completely redundant. All this is totally redundant. There's no need for it. We don't need to practice what we are. But because of our continuity fear, we do need to practice putting practice down, setting it aside. So at this very instant, set all practice aside and shift attention into clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. See? So we are practicing this as a means to set down practice. And this is the whole non-dual path. Okay, this is radical Dzogchen, this is non-dual path, this is what it's all about. And this got confused. And people thought that, oh, it means we don't have to practice. You know. So what happened was a lot of people in the West and the East, all over the world, have gotten this impression that by just not practicing spiritually, they're already liberated, you know, it's like they're liberated. And so they stopped. And this is got it backwards. We're so enmeshed in practicing arrogance that we have to be tremendous practicers of setting the practicing of arrogance down. It's essential. We have the severe continuity fear. It's the only problem we have. And the only remedy of that is to shift our attention to the clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. That's it. It's the only remedy there is. But this is something we have to abide in. We can't practice it. We just abide in it. So we have to free ourselves from the habit of practicing arrogance, because this is what we've been practicing for so long. So there are practices designed to free us from practice. And this is what skillful means is all about. Practices that free us from the whole notion of practice. The illusion that dispels all our illusions, and in doing so then is able to set itself down as well. You see, this is the key to A Course in Miracles. It's the key to all spiritual paths. It's the key. You do have to practice setting down practice. Because we think that practice is essential, because we think that more arrogance is the key to our salvation. And arrogance is most definitely has to be constantly practiced. And this whole world is nothing but practicing of arrogance. If we believe we're a body, we're practicing severe arrogance. If we believe in a world, we're practicing severe arrogance. We believe in time, space, process, and form, we're engaged practicing severe arrogance. If we believe in sickness, we're practicing severe arrogance. If we believe in circumstances and situations and victimization, we're practicing severe arrogance. So there's an entire situation here. Call it whatever you want. No matter how you slice the pizza, it's still the same ingredients are there. It's a massively severe practicing of arrogance. And so you absolutely have to free yourself from this through right practice, which the grace of God suggests to us. And that does not become an impediment. Okay, the right means, because in freeing ourselves from all this massive amount of practicing, we can go into abidance, and then we can see, oh, I don't need to practice this. And we can abide in that. It becomes easy. So if you can hear this, then again, the talent is right practice. You might call it right practice, skillful means. And again, let us go over this, that when some of these teachings circulated around the world, non-dual, Dzogchen, you know, Vajrayana Buddhism, various high teachings, it sort of filtered through to us. The ego sort of interpreted for us. We relied on egoic interpretation to some extent. And the ego told us, yeah, you see, you don't have to practice at all. That's the answer. Don't do the spiritual stuff. Don't really do it. You just listen to it, read books, that's okay, but don't actually practice. Because you're not supposed to practice. And so we've got this resistance to practicing now. This is exactly what the ego wants. Because we didn't stop practicing. See, the ego said, just don't do spiritual practicing, because that's the most intense practicing, and that'll add to your practicing. Now, spiritual practicing is designed to free us from the most intense practicing, which is the practicing of arrogance. which is all we do 24 hours a day, most all of us. Most people spend their entire life without even one instant given to something else, practicing arrogance. So the ego basically says, just whatever you're doing is fine. Well, what we're doing is practicing arrogance, and that's not fine in terms of salvation. So the ego misinterpreted, of course, all these teachings and gave us the false advice, as it always does, that, you know, just we're already there, so we don't have to practice. Well, you have to practice that you're already there. You have to reinforce it. It's a matter of preconditioning and reinforcing yourself to be okay with no practice, because arrogance is absolutely not okay with it. And arrogance says if you set arrogance down, you cease to exist, because it claims that. It thinks, see, arrogance believes that it's reality, whatever it says is true. So if arrogance says you cease to exist, it believes that's true. So arrogance won't let you set practicing of arrogance down. It tells you if you stop practicing, you'll cease to exist. So we're very frightened. And so we're not going to just stop all practicing. If we stopped all practicing, we would be in abidance just like this immediately. And we just stay there. That's it. But nobody's going to do that without preconditioning themselves to evaporate the continuity fear. So what the ego is basically telling us is do what nobody's going to do, just stop all practice. Nobody's going to do that because of the fear of arrogance. We're way too caught up in that. So the only other remedy is to practice setting arrogance down. That's the only remedy there is. It's the only pragmatic remedy that there isn't any other. And so we have, unfortunately, we went through a period where we didn't practice. So all the efforts of my 10 great Dharma protectors, spiritual mentors, has been designed to get me to practice. They say, when you do this, this is what will really work for you and for everyone. This is what works. So they've had a tough time getting me to do that, that's to say the least. But I have done it. And I keep thinking, do I really have to keep practicing? And I'm not a great practicer. There's different, But I'm a decent one. I'm a decent one. Pretty good one. Not a great one. But good enough, apparently. And this is what's important. As the ego tries to hold up these great practicers as if, like, this is what you got to do. And this is a problem. We hear about these superstars, you know, these spiritual superstars in the past who are just, you know, awesome practicers. And you think, oh, I got to sit in a cave for 40 years. And chant, you know, this a million times, this practice, then this one a million times, and just, it just seems like that's impossible. So it kind of, it intimidates us with these great teachers. But these great teachers never told me I had to be some kind of perfect practicer or all-time great or anything like that. No. He said, just use a little bit of will. Just do it a little bit. That's enough. Jesus said, it's enough. You're not being called to be a Dharma king at this point. Dharma prince, Dharma princess, you're called to abidance and healed perception. But, you know, that's your goal. So, you see, Jesus always said, just a little bit of willingness. All I'm asking you for is a little bit of willingness. Just a little bit. He said, God will do the rest. Just do the practices. And even if you don't think they work, and God knows, they didn't seem to work for me as I did them. I didn't get very much. It's subtle stuff. I didn't even know what it was. What was that? I don't know. Whatever it was quite subtle. No bells or whistles, really. It's like, wow, something happening? I don't know. But I said, he said, don't look for results. Don't look for results. Just do it. Just do it with faith. So So I was doing this practice of leave everything exactly as it is, and suddenly this tremendous freedom from this steel band that had been tied to me snapped. Suddenly snapped. Like a suspension cable on a suspension bridge suddenly snapping. You know, just something's really strong you think will never snap, and it just snapped. Gone. Now, it may have been the will of the ones trying to control me suddenly snapped. They just couldn't take the practice anymore. This had just caused them such consternation in their mind and their will to control me, to enslave me, that they simply couldn't take it anymore. They just snapped. And so that steel band of control that they were trying to exercise over me just snapped because their own will snapped. That's probably what it is. In those instances that's happened, like they just say, "Oh, you're just terrible. You're an idiot. You know, I'm never gonna have anything more to do with you. You're unteachable. You're on this." You know, they get furious with me, and they snap, and then they go away. So this was a major snap that happened. And it's funny. There's this guy. I told him I got a nail in my tire, and he said, "Ah, snap." That's what he said. "Ah, snap." And I said, "That's interesting. Ah, snap. By the way, I got the tire fixed. Got a brand new tire. Actually, I got a brand new tire. Road insurance. Just got that yesterday. Ah, snap." Now you see, the Dharma Kings will never snap because they're coming from love and peace and grace. But the ones who are trying to, who are on a spiritual ego trip trying to control you, they, at some level, they can snap. They get so frustrated that they can't control you. Your mind, it causes them, you know, furious. So this practice apparently caused this mind stream of someone who's been trying to control me to snap. Which is good. That's what you want. But don't ever engage. This is what is so crucial. I'm telling you, practice is the way. Don't ever engage at the level of dialogue and talking and arguing and this type of communication, relating. Just practice. As long as you're struggling mentally, horizontally with, they've got you. They've got you. But if you just practice. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. We have a number of practices here that are super effective. And you refuse to engage in anything other than just saying this over and over and over and over. Their desire to control you through your thinking, it snaps. They can't take it anymore. These subtle and psychic influences that are controlling you through thinking, your mind stream of thinking, they just can't, when you just practice, they can't take these practices. They just snap and they leave you. Casting out demons, Christianity would say, these prayers cast out the devil, cast out demons. It's true. It's true. It's absolutely true. So Christianity has a lot of profound truths that have been there all along, if we really had the capability to recognize them. All the great traditions do. Prayer or spiritual practice, right? Spiritual practice does cast out these demons who are controlling us. These egomaniacs who want to enslave us. These to build up their arrogance. They believe that salvation comes from more arrogance, and so they want to use us to idolize them, to build up their arrogance even greater, and they think that's their salvation. So they try to enslave us, and they can be very clever at it, very skilled at it. They say that, you know, give the devil its due, it's very clever. So give arrogance its due, very clever. But so only by saying these prayers, don't directly struggle with these psychic mind streams, these bands of control. Don't ever struggle directly with them. This is what the Holy Spirit told me. He said, don't struggle. We were kind of working on this one area that I came to my mind that we're going to get free of this problem. Be very nice. Don't engage at all with this, whoever it is, don't engage with them. Don't say, "Hey, I'm going to get free with you real soon. I'm going to get free of you real soon." You know, don't say anything. Just keep practicing. Just keep practicing. Stay humble and meek and just keep practicing. Suddenly, snap. He snapped. He snapped. And just let it be. Don't gloat, you know. Full stop in the wow. Don't feel sorry. Don't gloat. Just don't do anything. Just let it be what it is. That's all. Because you have to remain meek and humble here. Because arrogance, you don't want to engage with arrogance. Don't start thinking that you're a dragon slayer engaging with arrogance. You've got to be very careful about that. Just keep practicing. There are some, I don't know what he was, a cobbler or some real low blue-collar job in Tibet, and some guy just poor, maybe a poor little farmer or something. Nobody really paid any attention to his entire life, really. And then he passed away. And they went inside, and I guess he had some tent there or something. He was inside, whatever, how they do it. And they opened it up, and then there's just nothing but some hair and some fingernails or something, right? Left, there's nothing left. He just turned his body into the rainbow body. Because he had been, his whole life, he had been secretly practicing. Nobody even knew about it. So, you have to have this serious side of practice, practice side to you. And you don't have to tell people about it. I never have told anybody around me about it. At all. I've never told anybody I've been practicing my whole life. Except here on the videos. But socially, around me, well, no. Nobody even knows. You don't have to tell anybody. That's your secret side to your life. Not secret, but, what did I say? I did say secret. The practice side, serious side, the practice side of your life, the serious practice side of your life. If you try to tell other people about it, they'll start pulling into arrogance and say, "Wait a minute, you know, you gotta make sure you keep the arrogance thing going, right?" Because or they might say, "Wasn't that kind of arrogant thinking you can get free of arrogance? I mean, isn't that arrogance?" No, it's not. And they'll mess with you. They'll mess with you. So I found out my feeling was just keep it to yourself. Keep it to yourself and just practice. For the most part. If there's some sangha, if there's some really group, you know, that's one thing. But trying to go into too much detail of your practices to those who you're associating directly with is probably not the most advisable thing to do. Here, I'm functioning as sharing general knowledge with the world. It's a different role. I'm using myself as an example. That's a Dharma prince. They use themselves as an example. They get permission that the teacher, the Dharma king says, "Why don't you know if you could use yourself as an example to showcase, you know, what the right way?" But I'm not a teacher. I'm more a showcaser than a teacher, admonisher and showcaser, but not a teacher, not a guru, not a teacher. So you just have to practice for yourself to cause these snaps to happen. And it's kind of a little jolt. I mean, it's like, "Oh, what's that?" But it's not bad, because it's so deep. It's just kind of like something in the deep ocean happens, you know, and just like you're kind of near the surface, and you just say, "Oh, well, there's something, a little something happened down there, deep down there, maybe a little earthquake. I think an earthquake just happened down there." Oh, okay. It's not a big deal. It's not a big deal, really. But it's an attention getter. It'll get your attention. It's like, "What was that?" What just happened? Something profound just happened. I don't know what that was. But don't go searching for anything profound, really. You just keep practicing and be really into the practicing, which is what I really like. I love to practice. It's not easy sharing it on video. the depth of how I practice, but I try to do my best, because I don't want to overwhelm people with, you know, with it. It's just what you have to do is you have to come up with any situation that comes to mind and use that. So I can't give you exactly how to practice, because you have to know how to practice. This is what's important. And so you have to use your circumstances, your dreams, your circumstances, whatever comes to your attention, and identify the essence of that thing as, this would be a really good area to practice. This highlights, this is a good emphasis to use in this practice. Like, leave all awkward situations, leave them just as they are, shift your attention to clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. All awkward situations. And so whatever comes up, you have to yourself use that. Everything, as Ram Dass used to say, everything is grist for the mill. Or it was Richard Alpert, that Ram Dass. There's one in India, Ram Dass, southern India, a guru. Everything is grist for the mill, meaning, I guess, you know, grain to be ground. You have to use your own mind stream, your own attention stream, and say, oh, let me use that for the practice. This is the key. I cannot tell anyone just rotely, you know, mechanically, robotically. We were not robots. We cannot do, robotic practice doesn't work. Which is why Christianity has had trouble now, because it got too robotic. Too robotic. A lot of traditions say, just, you know, say this mantra, that'll work. Well, you know, if it's just robotic, that's not where it's at. Everyone's unique. And you have to learn how to practice yourself. You have to impress yourself. You have to gain confidence in your practicing. Those mantras, etc., those really have their effectiveness with the confidence the devotee has in the guru. Tremendous faith and confidence, and they say, I know this is going to work. And so the context of the practice, it has to be set in this sort of situation. You cannot just robotically repeat something and think that is necessarily going to be effective. So you have to look at your own defensiveness and everything that arises, you have, and use that for practice. Don't copy. You know, like someone trying to play like piano like me, they're trying to copy me. I said, don't copy me. That's not where it's at. You have to learn to pull upon your own inspiration and how to use that within your practicing. So you will have your own unique style, your own confidence. It's all about confidence, really. And so I played with confidence because I had my own style. I knew how to use inspiration that came to me and put that into the music, into the playing. I wasn't copying anyone. So I would tell them, you have to have your own, you have to have confidence in your own style, in your own inspiration, and how to put that inspiration into playing and practicing through that inspiration. That's the only way. You can't just copy someone. That's where the Dharma kings help us out. We ask, is it good enough? They say, absolutely, it's good enough. Jesus tells us, it's good enough. Do this. This will be good enough for you. So, okay, I can do this practice, and I can pull in inspiration within this easy general practice. So, you know, whatever it is, leave this and shift attention. Leave everything just as it is, this practice. Leave everything just as it is. Everything in this world that's happening, all thinking, all actions, everything that's taking place, leave it exactly as it is and shift our perception into clear light perception. Shift our attention to clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. Leave everything as it is, this very instant. Okay, so that's the basic practice. Now you have to start drawing various examples into your practicing that catch your attention, like, oh, this would be good to practice. Use this as a practice. This will really help me. I can't tell you what to draw. I can give you examples, but you have to actually be inspired yourself. You have to tap into your own inspiration. It's the only way. Leave all confusion just as it is. I leave all confusion just as it is in this very instant. Shift my attention into clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. Now these aspects that are trying to control, the aspects of arrogance which are trying to control us, saying, I told you not to practice like that. I told you not to do that practice. Stop doing the practice. And if you keep doing it, they just, their minds, you know, they can't control you anymore. They start losing, arrogance losing its grip on you, and they snap. And then just let it be. Just keep practicing. But arrogance doesn't want us to practice this way. Of course, it loses its grip on us. Leaving everything just as it is, I shift my attention to clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. See, that's the last thing that arrogance wants you to do. Arrogance wants you to keep struggling with everything. Keep trying to resolve it through your thinking, through your actions and thinking, and use it to gain more arrogance. So it thinks, I've got this whole world for you to help you gain more arrogance. So what do you mean you're setting it down this instant? You can't do that. How dare you do that? You know, it gets furious and all insecure. It gets very insecure. And when you practice ways, it gets very insecure. And one practice leads to another. One practice leads to another. This is what you will find out. And this is the key, like piano playing. You gain one practice and you gain really facility with this. Then it leads to another. That's even more effective. And another, and another, and another. And you keep stacking all these. You know, ultimately, you have all these practices that you're comfortable with. And then you have a lot of confidence. And so you play with confidence. And people feel that. They feel, whoa, this piano is not intimidating him. The music doesn't intimidate him. He's like, you know, he's just like, just not, nothing. He's not losing his confidence at all. Just went through that and through that and that. He's like, oh, he's like, they don't lose their confidence. That's what you're looking for, right? Someone doesn't lose their confidence. They're up there on a high wire, and it's like, what high wire? There's no high wire here. I'm doing cartwheels on the high wire. And they're just like, wow. Wow. Like that. So it's the confidence. Ultimately, of course, to abide, we have to have confidence in abidance. And to do that, we have to snap these bands of arrogance that have been holding us down. Because arrogance says we can't abide. It's impossible. That we have to practice abiding. We can't actually abide. You see, this is the duality. Is, well, how did you get to abide? How do you abide? How are you abiding? What practice is holding you in abidance? No practice. I just have confidence in abidance. And arrogance is simply no longer attractive to me. It's not a practice. It's just simply not attractive. Just a practice isn't attractive to me anymore. I don't need it. It's not even the practice of no practice, actually. It's just that I realize I don't need it. And of course, arrogance doesn't understand that, because arrogance has to practice. It cannot maintain any plausibility unless it's ceaselessly practicing. Its whole basis is that it somehow can empower itself to arrogate truth. A new, whatever it says is true. It thinks it can get enough power to overcome God. But it needs all this practice, 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 all this energy. It needs energy. It needs Shakti. It needs all this. It needs, so these big heavyweight gurus, fake gurus, they want everyone's energy. They suck all this energy and money and everything. So, you know, so they could empower them to so that their word is now truth. And people, we go along with that, think, wow, you know, arrogance. It's just more arrogance will finally work for us. And of course it doesn't. It's a disaster. So don't engage with arrogance. Just practice. Practice, skillful practice. Just keep practicing. I don't practice enough. I could practice a lot more, actually. But yeah, I guess you could say I stay engaged almost all throughout the day, one way or the other. Nonstop engagement. As far as like real intense practicing, you know, not enough, but I don't want to. It's a little, as Jesus said, a little is enough, really. There's so much grace. God has so much grace for us that just, it's more like doing the right practice. You can do a lot of practice that isn't very effective, but when you do the real powerful practices, you don't really need to practice that much, actually. You don't, it's not like you have to say this a million times, because the results are very quick in coming. I did this practice twice for maybe the first time, like maybe 3 hours, 3-4 hours. This one like an hour, maybe. Not very long, but intensely. And pow, the result was there. And so then you have to manage your success on the path. Like, wow, that was really successful. What is key is just everyday practice. Okay, this is what is the key. Whatever you do, try and do some practice every day. Try and, you know, whatever it is. It doesn't have to be something that someone else has suggested. You might have something come to you in your own mind to be inspired to practice in some way. Like I was practicing guru power, Longchenpa, guru power, Longchenpa. That's a practice. That's an empowerment. So give all power, all empowerment and permissions to Longchenpa. All empowerment and permissions to Longchenpa. Jesus Christ, Anandamayama. Holy Spirit, Longchenpa, Jesus Christ, Anandamayama, Holy Spirit, Longchenpa. You know, these are powerful practices. Jesus Christ, Longchenpa, Holy Spirit, Ramana. Jesus Christ, Longchenpa, Holy Spirit, Ramana. Okay, those kind of, I'm doing practices like that. Very, very potent. Very potent. I could feel it, just wow. The secret of success is practicing. It's always been that way. But the will to do these potent practices, this is the key. But you can't force it. Don't like chug a bunch of energy drinks and do it. This is out of control. This is artificial will, okay? It has to be natural. It has to come to you naturally so that you're still have poise and can coast whenever you need to coast. So you build up real confidence. Otherwise, if you're getting confidence... that was strong. Lemon juice there. Whew. If you're getting your confidence from a bottle, like drinking drugs, sex, drugs, rock and roll, artificial confidence, you become addicted to it because you think, how can I keep practicing? Oh, I need that. I need to, you know, drink the drug to keep get enough confidence to keep practicing. But all the while, the dependency is undermining your confidence. And you're not really building momentum. So that's very much a no-no. In every tradition, the sex, the drugs, and the rock and roll are absolutely prohibited. The false confidence, all this false confidence stuff, artificial will. You cannot rely upon that. It's a very slippery slope. Sure, I could drink some energy drinks now and practice all day and maybe all night, and you know, try to reach by May 27th. I'm going to be ready. You know, so I'd be a wreck. I'd be a wreck. The wheels would come off. So do as much as you can, but never rely upon artificial ways to push yourself even more. If you have to rest, then rest. That's the best. Sometimes the best strategy is to rest, which I have learned, and I do that. I slept in today. I slept in yesterday. I needed to. The stress is just astonishing right now. The pressure. So that's often the best medicine is often rest. It's the arrogance that's caught telling you to use these artificial aids because it knows it will bring about your failure. See, so it, initially it seems like you're going faster, but in the long run, you end up losing your confidence and failing, and that's what arrogance wants. What arrogance hates is for you to not use any of that artificial stuff and just full stop in the wow and keep everyday consistent practice. Arrogance knows that this is what will break its spell, its hold on you. This is what it's scared of. So it always says, no, do it faster. You don't need to do it every day. Why don't you get it done right now? And then tomorrow you won't have to practice, you see? Don't ever fall for that one. You just say, look, no matter how fast I go, I know tomorrow I'll be working at it even more with greater perseverance and determination tomorrow. No matter what breakthroughs I have tomorrow, I know I'm going to be at it again for sure. And so I better make sure that I don't burn out, right? Because I'll be working at it no matter what, no excuses. So I've had great experience with all this. Just the last 60 years in this world. You know, it's a microcosm of history. Absolutely it is. Same old. And how many have made it? How many have burned out? I can tell you that a lot have burned out. Everybody's looking for a shortcut. What is looking for a shortcut? Arrogance. The real shortcut is practice every day. Arrogance precludes that. It says, no. So the real shortcut, people don't use it because arrogance blinds them to this. Arrogance says, you don't need to practice every day. You're better than that. I say, well, maybe if I practice every day, I'll be really, really great, which would be a helpful thing. So I want to be as helpful as possible. So let me just keep practicing every day. And then it tries to scare you. Well, you're going to end up like some great Dharma king. I said, well, you know, I've already associated with Dharma king, so if that happens, it happens. It's, you know, if that's meant to be, it's meant to be. So it doesn't really scare me one way or the other. So the arrogance will try to scare us, you know, one way or the other. You're going to fail. No, I'll succeed. Well, you're going to succeed too much. No, you know, not right now. You know, if that eventually... We all have to succeed ultimately anyway, so I might as well prepare myself for that as best I can. So let me keep practicing. It's an owl, huh? What's that mean? Who? Or... Or is that a dove or something? What is that? Interesting. We have owls around here. Occasionally, some people have found them, seen them, and I've seen them, but they're pretty hard to ever locate, but they birds are pretty good at not being found. Of course, insects, animals, they're amazing. It's just, this whole world is a place of hiding and camouflage, actually, isn't it? The animal kingdom is just amazing. Where do birds go when it rains? You know, they just disappear. It's like, where are they? Where do they go at night, birds? It's like so many birds around. You ever see them at night? Do you ever see where they are? No. Where do the squirrels go? Where do all the animals go? I don't know. They've all go somewhere. And the insects, where do insects go at night? I never come across them, you know? It's just extraordinary how adept they are at hiding. This whole world is just a hiding place. We're practicing hiding from God. This whole world is just a dance of arrogance. That's all it is. So practicing, again, it's your own inspiration. You have to do it yourself. If you're able to do that, then you're absolutely on the right path. And nothing can stop you. When you practice, nothing, arrogance can't stop you. It will try, but it will fail. And don't dwell on the failures of arrogance, just keep practicing. Okay, don't dwell on the failures of arrogance, because it's a total failure, actually, and that's kind of overwhelming. So just keep practicing. Don't look back. Don't look back. Don't look back. It's very important. This band snapped of arrogance snapped, arrogance trying to control me. It snapped. There was a screaming of cursing and oathing and anger and consternation and falling away. But I didn't really look at it. It's just, okay, that happened. And then just keep practicing. Don't look back. Because, of course, the failures of arrogance, that kind of shakes us up, because we've been relying for so long on arrogance for our salvation, that when it loses its grip upon us, it's like, wow. Wow. So don't gloat over it at all. No gloating. No gloating. Just keep practicing. Just keep going. Because this will happen for you. Absolutely. You will have success. You will have, when you practice, you have success. And you have to know how to manage your success. Arrogance starts falling away. You don't follow it. Don't examine it. Don't dig into it. Just let it go and just keep on practicing. Don't gloat. Don't gloat. Don't brag. Don't gloat. You know, just stay humble and meek. You can be aware of it. I'm mentioning it here. It's important to mention it. Don't gloat over its demise. You know, just keep practicing. Arrogance will try to get you to gloat over its demise. That's another trick it has. Those who are like highly robotic need to have a certain type of teaching that works for them. I tend not to be that way, very abstract and used to being inspired, constantly inspired, being an artist and such. So the robotic, the more strict ways don't work very well for me. But I understand, like Zen, some very approaches, like, you know, just you just sit there facing a wall. Bodhidharma sat in a cave, supposedly, for 8 years, just staring at a wall. Okay, sure, you could do that. That's a certain approach. And the Zen approach of just, you know, Zazen, of staring at a wall, or just sitting there, and you have these guys with sticks, you know, hitting you know, are like, has to keep you awake, but, you know, don't talk. What did you find? I found that, shut up, you know, be quiet. It's like, huh? This is a certain approach, the severe approach. Another great piano player, Clara Schumann, in the 19th century virtuoso. She was a virtuoso because of her dad, who was this very strict teacher, piano teacher. He's very strict. He was ruthless, 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 ruthless. But she needed that. She needed that approach. If you give a more laissez-faire, you know, or lax approach, it could not be disciplined. Because some people, they're so used to be, you know, following arrogance of what to do. Like, okay, I did exactly what you told me to do. I did exactly what you told me to do. So my salvation depends on that. Then they need a stricter approach. Like, what do you mean you did what I told you? You didn't do what I told you to do. It was just right. What? And so they kind of like it uses their own attempt to be perfect and please that way, and you have to push those people in a certain way. That mindset has to be pushed in a certain way, so they can break through that. So there's different approaches depending on, you know, how you've been dealing with arrogance. And I don't, you know, resonate with those approaches of my own, because inspiration just keeps coming to me and keeps coming to me, and like that, it's a different style. You know, those who are trying to please arrogance, that's been their style. Then they have to have a teacher that nothing pleases them. See, nothing. What did you do? I had great success. I practiced, you know, for eight hours today. I said, I'm trying to get it up to nine. I'm doing all this. What do you mean you practiced for 8 hours? You didn't do anything today. It was terrible. What are you talking about? Shut up. Are you practicing right now? Well, then shut up. Practice. Don't tell me how long you practice, you know. And like, what? I thought I was pleasing, you know, arrogance by practicing like this, and the teacher's not pleased. See how these teachers, nothing pleases them. Claire Schumann's dad, nothing ever pleased him. So she kept trying to please him, but in an attempt to keep pleasing him, she had to practice more and more and more and more and more and bring everything to it, you know, like that. And finally, just realized, I can never please him. And then suddenly, I can never please arrogance. It never works. Oh my gosh. So, this is a way that you sometimes end up with a tyrant, you know, like that. This is where, quote unquote, the crazy wisdom supposedly comes into it. But that can be exposed. That can be manipulated, and it's a dangerous thing. Because they can always say, well, no, I'm just a tyrant that you need, right? So they had better have some, the tyrants better have some lineage, you know, that is really, that they have been okayed, you know, in the right way through the right teachers, etc. That sort of really strict teacher. That's why the ones that aren't legit, they go seeking for some sort of, you know, legitimacy from other teachers and desperately trying to get it from them, so they can say, oh yeah, this teacher said I'm legit, and the other teacher might say, no, I never said you were legit. So there's big arguments about that, you know, that kind of thing. So yeah, the tyrant sort of teacher for some seems to be necessary. Those who think that just by pleasing everyone, that's going to save them. You know, this is the answer. By just following what arrogance has to say perfectly, they themselves will be perfect. And so, yeah, they have troubles that way. None of my teachers are that way, actually. They help more with those who are getting this you know, stream of inspiration, and are very abstract minded already, and can be inspired to practice, come up with their own practicing, not really trying to please other people. I don't really try to please others so much, you know, about in any way. So I already have, had a lot of confidence already. That wasn't that I'd earned through my own hard work, and diligence. So it didn't just come from doing what somebody else said as far as pleasing somebody, pleasing the teacher, these teacher pets. I was never a teacher's pet sort of type at all. I said, I don't need to do it just exactly the way they tell me to do it. I have my own inspiration. I can call on that. So that's very good. That's very, very, very helpful to have that. Absolutely. But not everybody's that way. Some are just really good at following orders and thinking that if they just follow orders, right, that's it. And so these teachers will give them all these orders, and then they say, well, you didn't follow my orders right. What do you mean? You said you did it right. I don't think you did it right. And so they're very capricious and kind of crazy and that kind of thing. But again, that is something that can be exploited and has been. So it's certainly recommended that as much as possible, try to practice on your own in terms of coming up with your own inspiration for what to use in terms of, the root practices are given out here. That's the basic structure of skillful means. But as far as what emphasis in you use, you can come up with your own. Like, I don't have a ... problem. I have a continuity problem. You can say, I don't have an anxiety problem. I have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem I have. It's very severe. Yes, it is. It's very severe, but it's the only problem I have. It's the only problem there is. There is no other problem, actually. No other problem exists. So I don't have any anxiety problem whatsoever. The only cure for the continuity problem is to shift my attention to the clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. So, that's where I'm focused. That's my focus. The only resolution to my problem is this, you're saying. Now, that ... you can come up with whatever you want, whatever feels most effective for you in any given moment. It doesn't have to be anxiety. It can be anything at all that occurs to you that you feel is going to be really effective. And so this is the way you practice. So the practice, this ... in them. So like I say, I leave this ... exactly as it is and shift my attention to clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. That ... can be whatever occurs to you. Now some will say, no, you got to tell me what to use. So they're used to following orders. They I can't have any inspiration of my own because arrogance doesn't like that. So you got to tell me. I'll follow along exactly what you tell me. That's robotic. And some of these who do that, they finally are driven to despair because it's never good enough, and they have this breakthrough, and they think they're enlightened. But the real good teachers, tyrant teachers who are legit, they know that this isn't enlightenment. This is just a breakthrough into inspiration that they finally decided, I'm going to use my own inspiration here. But the ones who are fakers, they can drive you to the despair, and you have this breakthrough into your own inspiration, and they claim that you're enlightened when you're really not. Okay, and then that way they can control you, you see. Whereas the real ones say, no, you're not really enlightened. You've just made this essential breakthrough to your own inspiration. And now you don't need me as much, you see. Now you can practice on your own. Or the other ones will say, the fake ones will say, you had this great breakthrough, but you're not able to stabilize it, so you have to rely upon me I'll stabilize it for you, but you have to get into a closer relationship with me in order to stabilize it. And there, you see, that's how they start. That's their trick. And so the one thinks, oh, I'm enlightened, yet it doesn't quite seem right. Oh, but I need a close relationship with the teacher so they can stabilize it for me. Okay, so I have to, give my will over to them and all this kind of stuff. This is the slippery slope. What they should be doing is practicing on their own inspiration more. Able to do that now. And then they'll have their progress will greatly accelerate to true abidance in clear light, perception of intrinsic spaciousness. But the liberation into our own inspiration might seem like clear light spaciousness. It has that feel to it. So that if someone tells them you're enlightened, they might believe it, And there's a flip side to it also. There's always a flip side that also some of those who want to control us, when you actually are enlightened, they'll say, no, you're not quite there yet. So they'll play the role, no, you have to use your own inspiration now. And they'll convince you you're not enlightened when you really are. They try to do that. It can work both ways. The key is for you to keep practicing from your own inspiration. See, that's the key, no matter what, isn't it? If you just do that, then these traps that are set up, there's these clever traps that arrogance has set up for us. There's some arrogance compose as teachers, and it certainly does. And one is never, the both of them say, one says, oh, you're enlightened when you're not, and the other says, you're not enlightened when you are. You see, that's the double trap there. Yeah. So just wow it. Okay, just wow this information. See, if you have that ability to just wow it, then you can't be stopped. You cannot be stopped. You say, well, I'm not enlightened. Wow, I am enlightened. Wow, just wow it. I came across this one teacher, and it's like no matter what anyone said, he said, yeah, that's a step along the way. That's great. There's something beyond that. And yeah, that, oh yeah, that okay, that's also that was good. But there's also something, a lot of stuff beyond that. And beyond. So it's always this one upsmanship. There's always something beyond it, right? So, oh, that's good. You're enlightened. Oh, that's great. But there's just something beyond that. Yeah. This is sort of game of one-upsmanship. No, when you're abiding in clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness, there's nothing beyond that except knowing, and you can't know while you're still here, actually. You cannot. So those who say they are, it's not true. You can't long remain here if you're doing that, and your body will pretty much stop functioning. Like Sri Sri Nandamayi would go into knowing, but body would become inert, completely inert. People felt as though she were like a trillion light years away. I mean, super remote, in some other complete other realm, so to speak, beyond realm even. It just she seemed to have left this earthly realm entirely, and yet her body was still here. And they have a difficult time bringing her back. That's knowing, and Jesus tells us you cannot remain long in this realm from knowing. The only thing that's above healed perception is knowing. There's nothing above that at all. Nothing above that. So don't get into if you practice more, you could get higher than abidance. This is not true. Abidance is the highest you can reach here in this world. So there are some that are addicted to practice, and they use practice to gain control also. You don't want to be addicted to it. So that's why I don't try to overdo it. Don't overdo it. But when you do it with your heart and soul, with this feeling of, and try to be adamant about it. that you're really serious and really mean it. Now, you might not be able to do that all the time. I certainly am not able to do it. But at least try to do it. You know, just try to bring intensity into it. Like, this is, like, my house is on fire. And I need help. I need this to work. I need to just to nail this. I really have to get after it. It's like a workout. You'd say, look, I really have to, I'm really going to give it my everything here. Because some things, just the form of practicing is, it will always get them higher and higher and higher and higher. That's not true. The goal of practicing is to free you from all practice. So you have abundance and clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. And at that point, there's no more practice at all, really. Because abundance is effortless. It's effortless. It's inescapable. It's inescapable effortlessness. We accept the inescapability of it. So, you know, we can't not be in it. So what practice? What do you mean talk about that? That at that point it becomes completely, you know, arrogant to suggest that. So there's nothing higher than that here. In terms of something that a practice could lead us to. You know, no. When you're already led to no practice, that's it. And you've noticed a lot of these gurus have dropped away and disappeared, haven't they? A lot over the years. That they're, you know, they're whatever it was. Not all of them, but a lot of them have just stay humble and meek, keep practicing. With intention that you're already successful, that you are a world beater. You must have this confidence. You are a world beater. You already are. Everyone is. But they just have to accept it. Just claim it. You have to claim it. You are a world beater. You have overcome this world. You absolutely have already. Holy Spirit has already freed us all from arrogance, actually. So we're all world beaters. Absolutely, we have all already overcome the world. It's just a matter of accepting this fact. This is a fact. We're all, actually, every single one aspect of spirit has already been totally liberated by the Holy Spirit. But we're just honoring time, so we make it seem as though it takes a while. But the more we claim it right now, the less time we, less we're honoring time. So it's all about claiming it now. Leave all efforts just as they are. Right now, leave right this very instant, leave all efforts just as they are and shift attention to clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. I shift my attention to clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. So in terms of to just stop or to just go. In terms of, okay, it's still going. In terms of, you know, the gurus liberating us and stuff. And no, we've already been liberated. Everyone has already been liberated. Holy Spirit did it in an instant. All we are doing is we're simply accepting this fact. So all that these practices do is help us accept this fact. And when we accept this fact, there's no more need to practice, right? It's done. It's done. It's completely already totally accomplished. The Holy Spirit has done it all already. So I'm already enlightened. Absolutely. Everyone's already enlightened. So these great teachers are teachers. They already know this. Jesus tells us this. It's already been accomplished. I've never had an external teacher. There's always been internal teachers. Now, some of those who are very robotic need an external teacher to just thwart everything they do, and then they finally get so upset they finally turn within, and then contact the inner guru. They say the real gurus are only here to turn us toward to the inner guru, which is our own self. And this is true. And well, once we get the connection with the inner guru, this is more powerful than the outer guru, actually. We more easily are led to right practice. I can just ask internally and a right practice will just come to me. It will be given to me. Anyone can do this. Everyone has the inner guru. Everyone's already liberated perfectly, flawlessly. No chance they ever fall back. Flawless liberation. Now, we can choose in our freedom to play this game again if we want, but that's not a falling back. We choose it with out of a sense of desire for adventurousness, but in terms of liberation from this, Holy Spirit's already done it, and there's no chance of us falling back from this liberation. Everyone's already liberated entirely. It's a little frustrating because you know this, and they keep acting like they're not. What are you doing? You're already liberated. No question about it. No, I got to honor time. I got to honor time. Well, maybe we could speed up that honoring of time, which is what we're doing. Now, example of being in touch with the inner guru, inner inspiration, like singing, when I sing a song along with the song. If I'm out of practice, I may sing just like they're singing it. Robotically, go along with what they sing, but as I get back in good voice and everything, or maybe pretty quickly actually, I'll start taking off on my own way of singing the song, blending it, being careful to blend it with what they're singing, so that it sounds great. So right away, I have this confidence to do that. Right away, as my voice starts to come to me, I'm able to control the voice. You know, I feel like okay, I can use it. Yeah, just to say okay, they're singing this note, I'll just sing this one. You know, and I make mistakes and stuff doesn't sound so good. It's fine. I just keep going. Out of every mistake I make, I might sing something really good like 10 times. So, well, who cares if I sing something that doesn't sound so good? I'll make more than make up for that. So see, that's an inner confidence. If you have that, you're not worried about being creative. But I don't sing in front of people because they say, oh, you made a mistake. Ha, I caught you. You know, like, you're not so good. You know, you're not that, you know, you're overconfident. No, confidence means you can make a mistake and it doesn't stop you at all from being creative. I say, well, at least I tried. Okay, that didn't work so great, but at least I tried and maybe I'll try something different now. Try this. But most people, you know, won't put up with that. They say, oh, come on, you're supposed to be performance here. I said, no performance. I'm showing you something more important than performance, which is how to practice and how to build confidence. Is the more you try, you'll find all sorts of stuff that does work. And so you build confidence. So when I hear a song, I say, let me try this. And in doing that, you might find something just beautiful. So, oh my gosh, that's just tremendous. And I did that a couple of days ago. I found some way of harmonizing. It was just great. I said, wow, I haven't heard that before. That's wonderful. But I made some mistakes in getting there because I said, let me just try to do something weird, different that I'm not used to doing. And you stumble a little bit and then you find your stride. It's very important. So when you practice, don't worry if something you choose doesn't seem to click. You say, okay, at least I'm trying. I'll try something else here. Let me try it then. Just stay with it like this. So really, you could use singing, but it's not as a performance. It's not as a performance. It is you're showcasing how to try different stuff and how when you do that, you'll hit. It's like jamming. You'll hit something. You say, "Oh my gosh, I never would have reached this if I hadn't have gone through, you know, been tried to be creative and tried to come up with something." Yeah. There's plenty of people you see on YouTube who can robotically play these difficult songs. these young kids that they're very good at, like, just, you know, I can do this because I know I played, you know. It's like, okay, well, you know, that's not really where it's at. I can tap, you know, Eruption by Van Halen, and they say, oh, well, okay. That's, so a machine can do that, pretty much. You can program a machine to do it. I want to hear something that makes an Eruption sound better. It's different, but it's similar, but different. Or that, you know, that blends with it somehow, but it's like, you know, it comes from your own inspiration. Huh? No, I mean, that inspiration is so great. If I just copy it, that means I'm inspired. No, it doesn't mean you're inspired. It means you're robotic. It means you've got capability when inspiration comes, but you know, don't get stuck in your copycatness. Don't get stuck in your ability. Just the ability to be used is not to be worshipped. It's not to be idolized. It's not to get stuck in. Just like our creativity, isn't it? This world is an expression of our creativity. It's not to get fixated on or stuck in. Ultimately, we'll be riffing off of this world, you know, so I can do something like this world. And actually, I'm already practicing that a little bit, some of the graphics I do and stuff. So how about this world? How about this is a world? And some video games, I guess, you know, doing some of that. I used to use these graphic programs. What's it called? Bryce, I think. Was it, you know, you make your own worlds, make your own planets, make your own stuff. I did a lot of that work with Bryce. I think it was called that. And make your own oceans, make your own stuff. Make it, you know, and it's like, wow, I can make it different, but it's really also really cool and beautiful. Make your own flowers. Yeah, I do. Sometimes imagination. Ultimately, we'll be able to even leave it all behind and go on to something that's way, way even more creative than worlds and universes. But we're not there yet. That's fine. We'll get there sooner than we realize, actually. What we're concerned right now is not to lose our progress. Because that's the danger right now. So even if you can practice a little bit, this is essential. Essential. Don't worry about being some world beater in terms of, oh, I'm a great practicer. No. Just make sure you keep working at it every day. So I can practice a little here. I can do this. I can do full stop in the wow. Well, I can do continuity for practice. I can do this leaving practice. I leave. I leave all the news just as it is. Just as the news is right now. All news, just as is right this moment. I shift my attention off of it onto clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. You can hold that intention and feel, hold the wow of it. That helps deepen it. Instead of robotically just repeating it, say, I gotta repeat it 20 times. Once is enough. If you just hold your intention that this verbal expression gave, hold this intention, and you'll feel this wow developing. And you realize this is very profound, extremely helpful. This reminds me of something. What is it? Oh, I'm already liberated. I'm just honoring time. Wow. And I'm setting down this honoring of time more and more quickly. So just one statement like that. Hold that intention and the wow can develop right out of that, and then you can just wow it. And so while you're practicing, make sure you're wowing your practicing. Don't say, did I do it right? Did I do it? That's not it. That's trying to please someone. Please yourself by your intention, and this will develop this wow in you. You'll feel it. Like, wow, I did it. Wow, that was very intense. I leave all news just as it is, this very instant, and shift my attention to alpha, pure light, clear light perception. Clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. Alpha, clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. Alpha, clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. You could add that on if you want, but I shift my attention to clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. And then just say it's a done deal. I did it. It's a done deal. It's already done. And you'll start to get this, you know, shakiness, like, wow, this is very intense. And then just wow that, full stop in the wow of that. See how easy it is to practice in a very effective way. Just 1 minute, just less than a minute, you can do this and get to the wow. Which is very helpful right now. We need to have these little pops, a minute practice, minute practice, minute practice. As we go throughout the day, that we can just turn to right away. Whatever happens, I leave this just as it is. And shift my attention to this very, I leave this just as it is, right in this moment. And shift my attention right now, I'm shifting my attention right now to clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. I'm leaving all agitation that I'm feeling, all agitation everywhere, just as it is, all agitation in this world, I'm leaving it just as it is, and I shift my attention to alpha, to pure light perception, clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. I leave all agitation exactly as it is right now, and shift my attention to clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. Then hold this intention. Now some you'll be able to hold better than others, you see, but this is just the basic form of the practice. When you hit on one that feels right for you, you'll feel it. You say, wow, let me just hold that. Like on a song, you're playing a song and you hit some chord or something, it's like, you should be able to just, you feel it and just like, and the audience, let's just hold that. And feel the song right there. Just feel it, how it's liberating. Feel the liberation of it. How many musicians do that, you see? Not many, huh? If any, not many, if any. You're playing a song and you should just be able to stop or just hold the chord, just, let's just stop here for a minute, you know. Let's just groove on this feeling right now we have. And a real hip audience would certainly do that. See, a hip audience helps performers, actually, entertainers and musicians, because they're willing to stop like that. Let's just stop right here. Or they could finish a song, and instead of saying, yeah, more, let's just stop right here. That's enough for right now, isn't it? And let's just all be silent together, and let's just groove on this feeling we have, this wowness we have. So I'm going to put my guitar down, I'm just going to sit here on the stage and sit in the seat, but I'll just sit here together. See, now that could be effective, you see. So you can use anything as Christopher Mill as far as effectiveness goes. I went to a concert with George Jones in Oakland. And I finally said, finally, after all these years, I'm going to get to see him before he passes away. This is really important to me. First concert I've been to in, I don't know, 40 years or more, whatever. I said, this, I gotta go. This is my one chance to see this all, you know, all-time great singer. George Jones is, in the history of the world, he's one of the all-time greatest singers. There's no question about it. You know, once in many generations type of a singer, talent, you know, all-timer. And I gotta see him, gotta pay my respects. So I went there, and the warm-up singer came on, started warming up the band, get everybody ready for Jones. But the problem is she kept singing. More songs and more songs. And after a while, people started yelling, say, hey, where's Jones? Come on, we want him. People clapping. We want George. Okay, we're ready. And she sang another one. He says, folks, he's a little late, you know, getting here. He's warming up, and just he'll be right with you. So we kept being strung along for like a half an hour or so. And finally, people started murmuring and say, what's going on here? It was really intense. And she kept making excuses. He's almost ready. One more and he's ready. He's had a long flight. He's tired. He's got a cold, whatever. More excuses. He's having a little problem with his voice, folks, and he's almost got it ironed out. Okay, so at this time, you know, everybody's like talking to one another. There's this huge buzz in the audience. What's going on? It was amazing. It's amazing. And I was just like, I was, you know, wow. I had enough kind of presence, spiritual awareness to just say, let me just go with this. Let me make the most of this. What's going on here? This is really different than I expected, but it's profound. There's something profound happening. Finally, Jones came out. There was like screaming, oh, this is great. Here he is. And he starts singing. And we just thought, okay, this is just going to be the ultimate. He was just warming us up for like this ultimate performance. And we were all ready for it. Now we're just, okay. And he starts singing. It's like, what's going on here? Is this some kind of joke? Or am I something wrong with my ears? I thought my ears are defective. Well, it doesn't quite sound right. What's wrong? And maybe he's just old. He's old, all the age is showing. No, it's something else. And so people kind of clap, like, and some people kind of booed. Gradually, he kept singing a number of songs, and they kind of started, some people started booing or catcalling. I said, what's going on with this? The audience started getting all consternation because it didn't sound right. And then, again, people started standing, yelling, hey, you know, what's wrong? Come on. Some people started getting aggressive, and other people started cheering him, standing up cheering him, you know, come on, because obviously he was struggling with his voice. And so he had this dichotomy, this polarization of the audience. This audience became very polarized. And some are like gotten very angry and yelling and cursing at him and stuff. And the others were screaming, come on, George, you know, we love you, you can do it. And it separated between the positive and the negatives. It really did. And it became very nasty. And went back and forth. The negatives would be screaming at him and start saying, we want our money back. And started yelling at him, demanding their money back. And the other positives would come back and say, no, George, we love you. Just great to see you, you know, and thanks for even showing up, and we're happy just to hear have you here with us, you know. And eventually, a bunch of the aggressive, angry people got up and walked out, and then they tried to start kind of a riot in the lobby. They were, you know, banging on the ticket window, we want our money back, and they were very hostile, and they were, you know, say, we're too hip for this, and they pretended they were so hip, and the rest of us were, like, still there saying, you know, yeah, just cheering him. Just thanks for all the great music. So it actually turned out amazing because I got to like just have this extended period of time of just cheering him and thanking him for all the music, even though he couldn't even sing anymore. And maybe that touched him deeply. He said, look, I'm really sorry. I'll come back and I'll give a free concert to you. I'll come back and I'll sing for free at some other time. He never did. But he told us, look, he said, folks, you know, and he was so humble about it all. And you know, nobody had really ever got to see him like that. Hardly anyone. I don't know if this had happened to him. He had bronchitis. He couldn't sing. And he said, folks, I just, it's breaking my heart. You know, I can't tell you how much it's breaking my heart. I know you came to see me. And I just got this bad bronchitis. I can't sing for you. And I'm just so apologetic. And I just bless your hearts. And so we were all cheering for him, and he just was almost in tears, you know. He just said, bless your hearts, you know. This means a lot to me that you're you're cheering me and I can't even sing for it. You don't know how much this means to me. You know, he really opened his heart up to all of us. He said, I'm human, you know? This is really tough for me. He said, really tough. You know, everyone was just giving him a standing ovation, just pouring out love upon him, you know? So the concert was actually better than if he had just come out and sung a set and went on. It became a very profound situation. And then he left, and we all went back into the lobby. Then there was all these people that left early, all these angry, you know, swarming yellow jackets. They were just cursing him and laughing at him, joking. What an idiot, you know, putting him down. And it's like, wow. Wow, boy, did they miss it. Boy, did they miss it, you see. They really missed it. They missed out on a very profound experience. You know, he's had our musical back all these years. When he couldn't sing, it was our time to have his back. So that was giving back right there. It was an opportunity for us to give back. We say, George, you've been singing for 50 years, great music, helping us all out, spiritually, really, because you helped us stay away from the terrible stuff. And so we have your back tonight. Thank you. Let us give back to you, you know. So it was awesome experience. So those who got it, you see, they were hip. It was a hip audience, you see. And it became more profound because those of us who were hip, really hip to George Jones, weren't just trying to be posers, you know, like, oh, like, yeah, I went and saw George Jones in Oakland. Yeah, I'm really hip to that classic country music. I know what it's all about. When we went out into the lobby and all these people had left and abandoned him, they're a bunch of posers, you know, they're a bunch of auteur, I'm an artist. I could see how their pose had been blown, their cover had been blown. They were so upset about it. But I was a true blue, you know, true blue fan and appreciator of George Jones. Could sing every song he ever sung. And have sung every song he's ever sung. And I just love him. And those who love George Jones, they just absolutely love him. And they're so, you know, I'm not a poser. I'm hardcore. And so I got it. And there's no way I'm ever going to put him down. I don't care if he couldn't sing anymore at all. It doesn't make any difference. He's already sung better than I've ever heard anyone ever sing. And just inspired me no end. Helped me out on my spiritual path, actually, a lot. Gave me somebody to harmonize with, you know? I said, this guy's worth singing with. The others are not quite as much, but this one, this one's worth really giving it some effort here. Man, I got to push myself here. Because if I don't push myself, you know, I'm just going to become a robot here. I got to push myself. So Jones really pushed me. I said, how in the heck can I get my inspiration up to that level? Wow. Very daunting task. Because they said Jones, when he went to the studio, he never sang the same song twice the same way. Every time it's okay, take this. And he sang it differently. He said, doggone it, George, you had it there before. I just wanted you to, you know, a little faith. And nah, he never sang the song the same way twice. So it drove the producers crazy. And maybe they tried to get him liquored up and drugged up just so he would be complacent and say, George, I just want you to sing it this way. This way I think it's going to be a hit. And he never would do it. So they'd end up taking like a little bit from this session, a little bit from this session, a little bit from this session, and then splicing it all together to get the song. Drove him nuts. Billy Sherrill could handle it. He knew it. He said, okay, George, that's fine. He'd get a little on tape, and put it together. Sometimes. Other times he'd just sing it straight through and boom, one take. That's good. Got it. And they wouldn't ask him to sing it again because they know it'd be different. That's how creative he was. Super creative. Super, super creative. So he pushes your creativity or something like that. Pushes your creativity. He says, how can I sing with him but not do the same as he's doing? I have to come with my own creativity. It's really challenging. So I was able to thank him. So it was great. It was absolutely memorable, super memorable. And he oftentimes would not show up in these earlier times. And then you'd have the same situation. Half the people get furious. They'd demand their money back. And the other half would just like end up like cheering him, even if it wasn't theirs. You know, like feeling, you know what? It's okay, George. You don't have to show up for me. You've already showed up for me so many times with these great songs. And they wouldn't get mad at him. So he had these groups. Half of people are mad at him, and half of them loved him even more. He says, you're probably in some honky-tonk singing for free, which was true. And they realized that. He said, well, you know, he didn't show up here because there's probably some people who need to hear more than we do, which is true. He'd show up for somebody and just sing for them if they needed it for free. So he may have, you know, been on his way to the concert or something and got sidetracked and said, you know what, here's some people in here really down on their luck, and I'm just going to walk in there and I'm just going to sing for like all night for free. Just, you know, free drinks probably. Just give me some drinks and I'll just sing for free. That other concert, you know, those guys, you know, they've heard a lot of my music. These people here need to hear me more than they do. And hopefully they understand. And they did. So it's very spontaneous about, yeah, I've got a date, I got to show up here, but people pay. I know, but doggone it, you know, here's some guy who's homeless and down his luck and say, what's the matter? Come on, let's go to this place and I'll sing for you for a while. Let me see if I can, you know, help you out in life here. Or he's on a way, driving on the way to a concert. He'd see somebody's down now and he'd stop and he'd talk to him and they say, what's your problem? He said, well, I lost everything, you know, the whole country song thing. My wife left all the bills piled up and left me, got no job, I'm sick. They repossessed my car, I got nothing. So I'm just out here with a bottle of wine, you know? George says, yeah, I understand that. He says, okay, I'll tell you what. Here's the pink slip of the car. I'm signing it over to you right now. This is now your car. And here's, a couple $1,000 to get back on your feet. And I hope you make it. And so the guy would drive off in his car and Jones would be walking the street. Somebody would drive by and say, hey, wait, are you George Jones? He says, yeah. He says, hop in the car. He says, George, I was too late to go to the concert. Let's go honky-tonking. And they go to honky-tonking and he'd get up there and start singing for people. And knock them out. They literally did this. This literally happened. You never knew what he would do. Because he'd say, well, and the next day he'd go to the car dealership and buy a new car. I mean, he had hundreds of cars. He'd just give them away to people who were destitute. You need it more than I do. Give you the shirt off his back. Because he knew he could just make more money by singing anywhere. He knew he had the gift. So he says, oh, this guy doesn't have any gift, but I can go, you know, just cut another record and make $1 million bucks or whatever. Not that much in that day, but make a lot of money, enough to buy another car. Or cars back then. You can buy a nice car for $5,000 or even two. I mean, yeah. And he said, the guy said, no, I can't take your car, George. He said, I'm tired of it already. Take it. I want to get a new one anyway. Got this new one that just came out. And so just take it. He was that way with houses, too. He's just like, yeah, he's with whatever he had. It's like, easy come, easy go. If you need it more than I do, take it. It's yours. I hope it helps you in your life. So you can see how he would get fans that really, you know, appreciated this mentality. Very much appreciated the spontaneity. People felt like, you know, this is somebody that is more than just music. It's something else. He's got a gift from God, actually. He did. He had a gift from God. Very few ever sung could sing like that. Had the gift of singing that way. And just giving it away, what the heck you want, you know, just give it away. I'll sing all night. Oh, the promoters say, I can't keep singing. You paid for 2.5 hours. Said, folks, let's just go all night here. I'll just keep singing until they drag, you know, kill the sound. I'm having a good time. Hope, you know, I know you are too. Why should I stop singing? Well, you know, they've already got their money's worth, George. You know, well, the heck with that. I'm all singing for free. Come on. I'm feeling it. Wasn't in the money. I mean, That's why he ended up penniless. But, you know, he didn't care. It's not about the money. But people helped him get back on his feet, and ultimately got a wife that washed his money real careful, you know, into her pockets probably. That's how it goes. But she you know, cleaned him up, kept him out of trouble, which is good. It's a good arrangement. It's called a free spirit. A free spirit. So, we got to honor that free spirit, you know. He said, I can't sing tonight. He says, hey, awesome. Awesome. His backup band was great. The other singer, this female singer, is really good. And so, we got great music, too. We weren't shortchanged on the music, you know. Just got to see him, you know, the real person, the real man. We saw the man, the free spirit, the humble man. You know, one of the greatest singers in the history of the world, apologizing to everybody, just as if, you know, they were just his buddies, you know. He wasn't any better than them. He wasn't pulling any big shot deal on anybody. He says, heck, you know, I'm no better than you. That's the way, you know, he treated everybody, really. And everybody got that, you know. Wow. You don't see that very often. A total superstar who's just like, hey, I'm just a arrogant fool just like you. I need to repent too, just like you. This other stuff, you know, that's just superficial compared to repentance. Just superficial. It can be helpful in a superficial way. Helpful, good. But, you know, hey, we need to repent. Everyone needs to repent here. We're all arrogant fools here. And he admitted, I'm an arrogant fool, you know. Very honest. And he was. I've got to work in my life. I've got to practice. I've got to, you know, just like you have to. So we all have to, no matter what our gifts are, we all have to keep practicing the skillful means of repentance. Skillful means of repentance. We all have to keep doing that until we reach abidance, which is the realization, the freedom from all practicing, which is the end of arrogance, because arrogance has no choice but to practice. It's must compulsively practice. So in our practicing, make sure it's not compulsive. Okay, very important. Make sure it's inspired practicing, not compulsive. Every time I practice, I do it in a different way. You know, it's just it's that way. It's coming from me. I'm inspired to practice by the Holy Spirit, by the grace of God. Yes, but it's not compulsive. It's essential that we finally get enough courage to stop practicing altogether, completely freed, 100% free of all practicing, which is abidance in the clear light of perception of intrinsic spaciousness. That is absolutely essential. We must get to that, of freedom from all practice, completely free of any sense of compulsive practice whatsoever. All practice. And then we can help others by showcasing practice, but that doesn't mean we're not in abidance. At that point, it's a different story. At that point, it's a different story that cannot be explained, really. You just have to have faith in that the ones who are truly in abidance, even though they're talking and using words and showcasing practice, they're not really practicing at all. And they see that. They know it. You have to have faith in that. Like I have faith in like Ram Maharshi. No matter what he says or whatever he's not leaving his abidance at all. he's eating, if he's talking, he's explaining, whatever. No, he's not leaving at all. So there's no call to confound it, right? And try to, you know, be clever about it. Say, hey, you told us not to practice, or you're suggesting a practice, what are you doing? No, don't confound it. Cloudy today, very cloudy. Cloudy and cool. This is the weather pattern right now here. A late May weather pattern that is quite different than what we're used to. But it's nice. It's beautiful and just as it is. Leave all weather just as it is and shift attention into clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. I have absolute faith in all four Dharma kings that they don't have some secret practice, hidden practice that they're using to stay in abidance, or they need that, you know. Now, I have absolute faith that they are resting in abidance, and there's no secret practice that they're using to try and remain there, so to speak, or that they're not telling us about. No, they are just relaxed, naturally disposed in abidance, in clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. There's no question about it. They are relaxed in that. It's not posed. They're not posing. Okay, they actually are relaxed in it. 100% faith in that. This is unquestionably true. So whatever needs to be suggested to us from them is legitimate. They're not insecure. In other words, they're not insecure in their abidance at all. It's genuine. It's genuine. So there's nothing they need to hide from us, you know, so they're not suggesting something practice that will hide, blind us to some insecurity they have, you know. No, no way. Got this, was at checkout in this grocery store yesterday, and this young woman comes past me. Teenage, quite young, maybe like 12 or something. She's all in this bright red dress, long skirt, long jacket and a blouse. It's all red. Everything is bright, bright red. And I say, whoa, what is this? I immediately said, wow, pay attention to this. So I started paying attention, and then her family showed up. And it was like a country dancing. It wasn't square dancing. Some sort of barn dancing outfit or something. She had some on the bottom. She had this white petticoat, like adornment on the red dress. Some sort of frills on it, ruffles on it, or some frills. Very interesting. I have to look into that. What that means. Anyway, so I was paying attention to her. Just said, well, she's going to do something to catch my attention here. I knew it. Her mom and dad and her brother was there. They're really horsey. You know, let's dance in the barn type of people. And at the end of it, she went to pick something up from the counter or something like that. She was there. I wasn't really paying that much attention. I kind of got distracted a little bit. And then she sort of was like bending over to pick it up. And so I turned my attention away from her. I said, I don't, you know, what is this? Is it a distraction or something? Women are very clever about that. Distraction, or at least arrogance is. Let's just say arrogance is. But she did it in such a way, you know, there was a modest way. She sort of bent at the knees. You know, she wasn't like bending over, that type of thing. But she was like bending at the knees and doing very modest like that. I saw that and just said, okay, interesting. So she was very, very skilled in natural modesty type of thing. And so this for me, it said, the woman in the red dress that appeared in my dream is here, of course, to block the immodesty of the world, right? Help us block the immodesty of the world and give us aversion training to the immodesty of the world. Now, when Chandra Tessering Chodron showed up, at appearances, Dakini showed up. And the next time I went there, I looked where she was standing. And there was all these little pieces of toilet paper, like frills, all decorated around this area. I said, what the heck is that? Very similar to the frills on this young lady's dress, this girl's dress. And I said, that's like bizarre, kind of, because that reminds you of like the toilet, you know? I said, this toilet paper? And now this Vajrayogini has showed up and empowered, given us this empowerment of this aversion training. Outhouse training, you know, like, yuck. Associate these immodest ones, these ones that are trying to drag us down into arrogance, more arrogance. Associate that with his extreme aversion. The toilet paper connects exactly with that. Vomiting pus, the stench of an outhouse, this stuff. That's exactly what this association is with. So this was a powerful, powerful sign of Vajrayogini there that this young woman who was dressed so modestly, yet in a red dress, and yet whose actions were that of a very modest girl who, with the white decorations that tied into the Dakini that showed up, Chandra Tessering Chodron, who showed up with the toilet paper, showing that the Dakinis have this practice for us, which is this aversion practice, which will shut the door on immodesty, in our minds. A very, very amazing situation. Because there's the arrogance has trained so many in this world, women, to be extremely immodest now. They have been in the 70s, 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, going. But there may very well be a burst of immodesty, or they catch us on the flip side of these very immodest ones pretending to be all very modest, pretense, but really in their heart they're extremely immodest, and in their skill, in their willingness, they're willing to be extraordinarily immodest, extremely whorish, the horrors of Babylon. There's a massive armada of horrors of Babylon. They might pretend to be all very modest. Okay, it could go either way or both. No, I don't know if this young girl was actually in her mind was very immodest and was just being fake, modest, or was she genuinely modest? But this pointed out the trouble that we're going to have. It helped point it out. So it's like this lady in the red dress was Vajrayogini pointing out, look out for the red dress, which these Illuminati whores of Babylon, who are going to try and ensnare us into arrogance. So that's an attention getter, isn't it? So she's already given me these practices, which are extremely effective. Why should we have our attention on attractive women anyway? We should have our attention on practice, spiritual practice. So I don't care who the attractive woman is, whether she's modest or immodest. Just see her as vomiting pus all over you, And her speech is like rattlesnakes, just poof, instant aversion. Because what we need to be doing is we need to be practicing our own, from our own inspiration, our spiritual practice. We don't need the inspiration of some beautiful woman to inspire us to practice. No, we have our own inspiration. It comes from the inner guru. If you want to be inspired by beauty, look at a picture of Longchenpa with the flower frames I put around him. That's safer, way safer, way, way safer. Don't allow yourself to be inspired by a beautiful woman. It's very dangerous. Or from a beautiful, a handsome man in some respect, some way, you know. It's your own inner inspiration that you use for these simple practices we have. So I leave all beautiful women and shift my attention to clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. Okay, you just say that. I leave all beautiful women exactly as they are, just this instant moment, and shift all my attention, shift onto clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. Because when I try to turn my attention back, all there is there is just vomiting pus. That's all there is. So I'm not going to put my attention on it. I'm going to shift my attention into clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. So Vajrayogini showing up in this red dress was getting my attention, showing me that this lamentable, she was crying, there's something so lamentable. There's just going to be this very lamentable situation coming in the world where these arrogant whores of Babylon are going to try and tell us that they're our inspiration. And she was warning me, and through me, everyone here, this, we must take drastic action now, aversion therapy, along with this spiritual practice of I leave all beautiful form, this very instant, and shift all my attention on a clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. And don't look back. Because she took me this aversion practice to the whole world is just this massive pus, ocean of pus, the separating deadly pus, hideous pus, with every malady possible in it. I can't even remember all the different plagues that we've had recently. I've forgotten the names. I don't even remember. There was one there for a while that was really scaring everybody, wasn't it? In Africa, the one that caught on in Africa so bad. So just imagine the world is just this ocean of pus with all of these viruses there, the Zika thing, but there was one before that, I don't remember. That, you know, the quarantined, all these African countries were quarantined. You know, then the avian flu, you know, Spanish flu, AIDS, everything. It's just this pus that has all these hideous diseases for us. And it's telling us to drink it. Drink me, drink me, drink me. Don't turn back and look at it. Turn all our attention to clear light perception of intrinsic spacious. I turn all my attention to clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness right now. See, all of it right now. And you leave all this behind this very instant. Shift my attention off it this very instant. This is the kind of practice that Vajrayogini has brought in. Now, it's kind of hard, difficult to get angry if they're like, right? Because you know, it's a Dakini, mother feminine thing. So, you know, if it was a man doing that, we might reject it. Say, what are you doing? But no, this is mother. When the real strong medicine comes in, it's usually the mother that needs to give it to us, right? She has to really plead with us. And you know, you got to take it, I'm telling you. So Vajrayogini has brought in these very intense practices. Super effective. Right in time before the horse of Babylon put the pedal to the metal. Which they're certainly ready, willing, and able to do. Now, whether they do it or not is still to be determined. Because we have free will. Everyone does. In spite of the arrogance, whatever arrogance says, the spirit still has free will to drop the arrogance. So maybe they won't do it. Maybe they'll drop it and say, maybe later we'll do this, but not right now. That'd be great, but we're not counting on that. Because they will certainly try to do it later too. right? So let's be sure that we have this practice nailed down. All praise to Vajrayogini, Vajrasattva, Vajradhara, Vajrasattva, Samantabhadra, the Holy Spirit, God the Holy Spirit, God the grace of God, the skillful means of grace, who have our backs, have our spiritual backs, and are very much aware of the imminent trouble, the storm that could arise. We never say it will, we say it could. Because if we say it will, then we're denying the freedom, our freedom. Everyone's perfectly free, so we're free to not have it arise if we so choose. So just keep practicing this way, and whatever it is that's trying to control you, whatever arrogance is trying to control you, that will snap the band of it. It will snap, suddenly snap, they'll snap, and they'll be free of that. Right now, they're trying to tell you, oh, this is terrible, what are you talking about, this is too much practice, oh, he's lost his mind, you can't trust this, this is awful, you know, there's resistance. That's just the arrogance in you speaking, trying to convince you not to do it. But I did the practice, and look what happened, this very strong arrogance that was trying to keep a hold of me somehow, they snapped, couldn't handle the practice, drove them nuts. They had to leave. You know, in exorcism in Christianity, they keep saying these prayers, they keep invoking this prayer, and this demon will just, they can't take it anymore, they snap and leave. Jesus cast out demons from all sorts of people because his very presence, they just couldn't tolerate it, the demons couldn't tolerate it. They couldn't tolerate his freedom, his lack of arrogance. They could not tolerate his lack of arrogance. And they fled. They fled. This is how it is. So you can practice. You have a practice you can use that will cause this inner demons, quote, arrogance, really, that's demanding more arrogance from you to serve their arrogance, to make them more arrogant. They'll flee. They can't take it anymore. They just have to quit. The pit bull has to open its mouth. You know, you spray pepper spray up its nose and it opens its mouth. Let's go of you. It's like pepper spray. Spray the pepper spray in the pit bull's eyes and nostrils and then let's see how long they hold on. You know. Hopefully, that gets them to relax their grip, right? But try to pry their jaws open and no luck. So this is like spiritual pepper spray to arrogance. Lemon seed. Good stuff. I'm drinking a lot of lemonade now. Cane sugar. Unprocessed cane sugar and lemonade. 4 grams of sugar per teaspoon. TSP, teaspoon of... all the sweeteners had said the same 4 grams of sugar. But, like I put in like maybe 2 to 3 teaspoons. So you get like 12 grams of sugar. How much is this normally? Let me look and see. Does it say? Sugar's 14 grams. So, they have 3.5 teaspoons of sugar in this bottle, or sweetener. 3.5. So if I put in 3.5, that's the same as just buying something off the shelf. Not too bad. Oh, before this ends, let me give you some good news. I mean, good news from anyone is helpful for all of us, right? All for one and one for all. The community of saints, the community of the Sangha, the community of repentant minds, community of repentant minds, the court of the Dharma King here. Good news is good news. I got on the scale this morning. Now, I didn't eat much yesterday at all. At the end of the day, I said, did I eat anything today? I said, I couldn't even remember. Did I eat breakfast? I had a spinach and strawberry smoothie, but that's about it. And I really didn't eat any. I said, am I hungry? I said, no, I don't need dinner. Actually, I ate a salad of garbanzo beans and iceberg lettuce, a mix of garbanzo beans and kind of some sort of salsa type of mix with it. That was pretty much it. Maybe some feta cheese I sprinkled on it. Yeah, I sprinkled some feta cheese. So I did have this nice salad, but I got on the scale this morning, and wow, did I see a number I haven't seen before. It's been a long, long time since I've seen that number. I can't remember the last time I saw it. Maybe it's been 20 years or something. I don't know if I ever got down that low, but 20 years ago I went on this and all-out diet then. Maybe I did get down, but I got down and that number was there and I jumped off the scale and said, that's good enough. I'm not going to re-weigh. I dropped like almost a pound. Yeah, I dropped a pound. And I got below my weight. I got below my, which is really my goal. I mean, I want to be below my the weight that I want to be at by May 27th. I want to be below it. So when I eat some food then, it'll bring me back up to it. Because obviously, I get a little weight because I haven't been eating any food. So there's not much food in me right now. So when I go back to eating, it's going to jump a couple pounds. So I want to be like a couple pounds under my ideal weight. So when I start eating again, it'll, you know, stabilize there. So I was under my weight, my target weight, under it. And today I haven't eaten anything yet today. Let me see, what time is it? 3 o'clock already. I haven't eaten anything. Just drank this lemonade. I might have had a couple walnuts, possible. A couple walnut pieces. I don't feel hungry. I don't feel hungry. I feel inspired. When you don't feel hungry and you still have energy, ride that wave. It means you're inspired, because at some point you're going to get hungry again, right? And then you're going to start eating again and your weight's going to go up. But man, I'm telling you, I'm just going to go for this lemonade and just make some more, and I'm just going to start drinking this lemonade. I feel great. Maybe it's the sugar. You know, well, I got some, you know, I'll eat some garbanzo beans and feta cheese, and I'll do a kale smoothie tonight, maybe, yeah. The strawberry and spinach was really good mix with some sort of fruit drink, V8 fusion drink, a Kai and blueberry fusion, V8 fusion drink. It was very good mixer. V8 fusion is very good. It's not just the tomato juice, it's got the fruit juice in it, too. It's really good mixer for smoothies, for the spinach and the kale. It really smooths out the taste really well. So I'll hammer a kale smoothie tonight. That's how into health I am. Kale smoothies. But no donuts afterwards. I'm not even stopping that. As we're headed towards May 20, was it 22nd today? We're just, you know, 22nd, then 23rd, 24th, 25th, 26th. You know, four more days, you might as well. You know, if you're on a groove, might as well hammer it. But don't overdo it. I'm watching it. Make sure I don't suddenly feel exhausted or something. But I'm it's so important. I'm into kale smoothies. Here's a secret with kale smoothies. Blend it up in your NutriBullet or juice or whatever you do. If you have a juice extractor, you're good already. But if you blend it up on a high speed blender, there's all this pulp in there, very pulpy. And that's, can't drink that stuff. I mean, it's just too tough. So what I do is I strain it. I run it through a strainer. I just pour it into a strainer and then use a spoon and smash, you know, against the side of the strainer so I squeeze all the juice out. And what you get left is all this pulp of the kale. And I just throw that away. You know, I don't try to drink it. That's too rough. I mean, I had in the past drinking that, but that's tough. I mean, because that just gets in your mouth, all this pulp. Yeah, no. But when you strain it out, boy, that kale drink goes down nice when it's blended with the V8 fusion and strawberries or whatever else, banana or something. It tastes fine. I got no problem drinking a kale smoothie. That's a big step, because the very idea of drinking a kale smoothie is like, ah, that's too much. No. Hey, I went to Whole Foods yesterday. I never go to Whole Foods, basically. I got corralled into going there. We call it Whole Paycheck. You know, I saw this stuff. It's just a tart red cherry juice, $7.99. I said, wait a minute. I just bought, you know, someplace else for $4.99. That's $3 more. It's the same stuff. Come on. I mean, what was it? Cold processed tart red cherry juice. Right? I don't know why it's so expensive. But come on, this is an affectation. Whole Foods is an affectation. Everything there is so much more expensive. It's packaging, you know, and people are buying status by shopping there. They're marketing slaves. They're slaves to marketing. People who shop at Whole Foods are slaves to marketing. Just like, don't be a slave to fashion. Don't be a slave to marketing, you know. Omega 3, organic this, blah, 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 market this. I'm so much better than other people because I'm shop at Whole Foods. And no, you're a slave to marketing. You're a fool. You're a fool. You can go to other places and get stuff. The same product is like $2 more at Whole Foods. You're just wasting money. So I got a couple exotic stuff there. I got mulberries from the Hunza Valley there. I've never had those. Yesterday I ate mulberries from the Hunza Valley. You know? So now I'm a mulberry eater. You know, I never knew what is that? It tastes like sesame seeds, basically. It's very expensive, really expensive. I got a couple of drinks there, like some Sula drink or some kind of thing. I don't even know what it was. I haven't drinking it yet. I'll do it later on today. Maybe I'll go in after this and drink that. Just so I know what the chic people are doing, you know, so I don't feel like, starts feeling insecure around the chic people of Silicon Valley. You know, it's helpful. You don't want to get insecurity, be careful about that insecurity, because then you start overcompensating. When you start on your spiritual path, you might try too hard. You know, I got to overcompensate. And so I say, So I just went around the whole store looking at everything that was in the store. So is there anything there that makes me feel insecure? The Hunza berries, or the mulberries from Hunza Valley. So I feel a little insecure, like maybe some people are eating those, you know, and okay, let me buy a bag. And so I, you know, ate a few and say, no, okay. Oh, yeah. What did you juice it? Well, I threw in a few Hunza mulberries, the golden ones, you know. Oh, not the purple ones, no, the golden ones. Yeah, I like the golden ones a little better than the purple ones. So they got purple ones too, different kinds of. And of course, goji berries, I've already had those. So I'll have some goji berries and mulberries from the Hunza Valley with my kale smoothie. V8 Fusion kale smoothie with Hunza and goji berries. I mean mulberries, mulberry and goji berries from the Hunza Valley. Okay. No insecurities there. You know, no health fat insecurities there, right? I mean, it's like pounding it. Are you kidding me? But mostly I like to make my own lemonade. You know, I squeeze my own homemade lemonade, fresh lemonade. That's, you know, it's free. Except for the sugar. Wow. How are we doing? Oh, we got one of these things where we got low. I can go and go and go because it's a low gigabyte. Silicon Valley, man. I'm telling you. God, I hate going into Whole Foods. The people in there just... The cashiers, man. Wow. I'm dangerous. I've got a half-shaved head and piercings and tattoos, but I got a trust fund also, and I'm don't really need to be here, don't really want to be here, but I'm just doing you a favor by being here. What'd you buy today? I don't really like what you bought today. This? Yeah. I had to ask him, could you put this in the bag? He said, I don't know. I don't know if I have a bag or not. Let me see. Maybe should I look? Maybe I'll look for a bag for you. Is this one going to work? I don't know. Am I supposed to know how to do my job? Not really. Not really. But, I'll put that soup in there anyway. And put it aside. What the heck? Okay, now what else? Like, wow. And the other store's like, how are you? Great to see you again. You know, look at this great food you're getting, you know. Talking in a super nice way, and great to see you again, you know, see you next time, and just positive, you know, support. It's like, good Lord, it's like night and day, it's like going to the Whole Foods is like going into hell, actually. It's like, you know, you're supposed to be there. What are you doing here? You don't deserve to shop here. Everybody's like looking at each other like, I deserve to shop here, but you don't. You know, that's the feeling you get. whole rejection, you know, going to whole rejection foods. Like thinking like, do I really deserve to shop here? Do I really have the money to shop here? I have the money to shop here, but I don't think you do, you know. Yeah, I'm getting to the, you know, getting to $7 for a couple of pieces of fruit here. And everybody's so into themselves there too. Like they're so self-absorbed. It's like this whole, you go into this whole thing of like total self-absorption. It's like, ah, wow. Let me get out of this place. Other grocery stores, I mean, they got the music going. I danced to it. I was doing all those different walking steps and just grooving to the whole thing. Nobody, they like look at you and smile and say, yeah, you know, that's cool. I mean, you can, you know, you can just be yourself. Nobody's like thinking like, do you really belong here? Like, you gotta, you know, you don't have to pretend like, yeah, I belong here. I go, what do I need? How do I need to be robotically, you know, to look like I belong here? No, it's just like, there's no feeling like if you know you belong here. You go to the right, good grocery store. The people, every time they walk past, they smile and say, "Is there anything I can help you with?" And you say, "Oh, if I say great," you know. And they're just, if you you can go to anyone to ask them, and they'll say, "Sure, I'll find this for you." And they won't give you this feeling like, "Well, you're kind of stupid," or "Why do I have to help you?" Or, "I really have to help you." I guess no. I mean, it's just like, you're treated like you're a VIP. You walk in the door, you're a VIP. Plain and simple. Plain and simple. You're the customer. You're the VIP. You can do no wrong. Oh, I forgot something. Don't worry, I'll go get it for you. Your cashier says, oh, no, that's fine. They can wait. The other cashier's going to wait. And they go off and they get it for you. Like, what? Wow. And the other customers aren't upset. They say, that's cool. It's fine. We're not so important that we're in such a big hurry, you know, that we can't wait for like 10 seconds. Hi, how are you today? You know, good. So how are you? So, I'm wonderful. You know, how, we got something going for your weekend. You know, you start chat. You chat with the bag. You chat with the baggers. Nice to see you again. And is this okay for you? And can I take stuff out to the car for you and stuff like that? They're always offering to help. You know, this is a way a grocery store is supposed to be run. Like you're among friends, you're a VIP here, and you're among friends, and take your time, take as long as you want here, get whatever you want. It's just, you know, you can't do any wrong. There's no such thing as wrong choices of food here. Coming for one item, that's great. Shopping for food is like one of the basic things we all have to do. So you really appreciate it when people treat you right. I look forward to grocery shopping when you get treated right. I went into one store and the bagger said, this is the healthiest bag of food I've seen all day, except you got those Cheetos in there. I said, well, they're not mine. Someone else put those in there. You know, it's not for me. They said, oh, sure. But just kind of making a big deal about like, wow, you're kind of a health nut, aren't you? And that was kind of a snarky thing. You know, she was kind of like, that was one of these self-absorbed, you know, elitist stores. Like, wow, nobody else is so healthy. Are you? What, who do you think you are being? You know, I actually said, this is nothing for me. I mean, this isn't that healthy. You should see my other stuff. But she said, no, this is the most healthy of anybody. Whereas the other store, you know, they don't say anything about it at all. It's just, I even have to apologize. Yeah, I'm getting lost. They say, oh, that's great. That's fine. Okay, you get whatever you want. They don't judge you on on the food you buy at all. They're trained that way. You know, they say, oh, this looks like you're some sort of super health food person or something. No. I mean, there's just one lady that came in there, that store, and she bought like 50 bunches of bananas or something. It was like crazy. Her whole basket cart was full of bananas. And I was like, wow. And they asked the cashier after that. I said, that's kind of interesting. And they said, well, no, she's really into a banana diet, you know. And so I was trying to see if they would kind of judge her. But they didn't. They refused to judge her. I refused to judge her, and I was really impressed by that. I was kind of see, wow, that's kind of weird, huh? And they said, well, I mean, just people have unique stuff. You'll be surprised. People get a lot of, you know, unique diets, and they have something they're into, and then, you know, it's okay. So then I felt very safe and comfortable shopping there because I can get whatever I want to get. bunch of, you know, kale, whatever, probiotic, you know, whatever. I'm not taking probiotics, my probiotics these days. I'll take them for 2 days and then stop, forget. My vitamins, I'll take them for 2 days and stop. But at least I can say, oh yeah, probiotics, sure, yeah, I like the refrigerated one. Good for you. The kefir, yeah, stop taking that for a while. I'm not doing anything, I'm not eating anything right now, actually. Just kind of stopped eating, which is wonderful. I love just stop eating. Isn't that great? Leave all eating exactly as it is. In this very moment, I turn all my attention to the clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. Leaving all food exactly as it is, I shift my attention to clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. How are we doing here on the... Oh, okay. Rolling right along. So you see how you're just going along in life and then something will strike you. Why don't I use this to practice with? Leaving all food exactly as it is. In other words, all the food in the world, in the grocery stores, in restaurants, in the refrigerator, on tables, everything. Imagine just someone taking a fork to their mouth or going to drink something and frozen in place, leaving everything exactly as it is. Musical chairs, the music stops. Everything's frozen in place. Nothing more happens with food whatsoever. I shift my full attention onto clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. Hold that pose right there. Frozen. Everything, all food, completely frozen. Nothing else happens with food at all. Someone's chewing a mouthful of food and stop. All food exactly as it is. I leave it all exactly as all food. I leave all food exactly as it is and shift my full attention to clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. Just like that. That's how to practice this. So bring the practice into your life. Okay, bring the practice into your living. Bring the practice into your life. It's a little chilly out here today. You know, it's not sure if it's going to go towards summer or back towards winter. The weather's ambivalent right now. Or maybe it's saying, are you sure you want to go into this summer time? Are you sure you want to go to the summer? Well, ready or not, here it comes. Keep your eyes on summer, this summer. Keep practicing these intensely effective practices. I leave all thoughts exactly as they are, this moment, exactly as they are right now, right this instant, I leave all thoughts and shift my full attention to clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. Amen, 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 and amen. However you want to say, Hari Bol, Hari Bol, Hari Bol, Hari Bol. You could say anything you want to say or nothing. Are just wow, 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 wow. To kind of let that wow develop. You say Om Mani Padme Om, Om Mani Padme Om, Om Mani Padme Om. You could use anything a little device if you want to just stay with that wowness of that, what you just said, what you just affirmed. what you just decided, what you just chose. Right now, I leave all thoughts just as they are and shift my full attention to clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. Wow. 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 I tend to just use wow. It's very ecumenical, isn't it? And it directly points out our experiencing as wow. Directly points it out. Now, I'm feeling a little instability here. It may be that I shouldn't push this recording too far. And maybe we've done enough. Maybe we've done enough. This is what I'm considering. Leave all this right this instant. Leave all activities just as they are, and shift our attention onto clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. Amen and amen and amen. Good. The microphone's been here. Sometimes I don't notice it. So this has recorded. Yeah, I'm probably getting chilly out here. Yeah. Just in a light t-shirt. It's not quite t-shirt weather yet here. That's for sure. You may be getting a lot of help right now in your life. I'm getting a lot of help. I ordered something yesterday. The problem I've had with swimmer's ear for a long time. I had to stop surfing because of swimmer's ear. It was a terrible problem for me. So many infections and sicknesses and illnesses from getting water in my ear. Of course, every time I shower, I got to prevent water from getting in my ear. So I have put wax earplugs in my ears. But they stopped making the brand that I used and that's most effective. And the ones that they sell now, well, actually, they're not that effective, and some water gets in there. So I certainly can't swim. I have to stay out of water, away from water entirely, which is terrible because I was like a real water aquanaut, really, when I was young, very much so. I was always swimming. Loved swimming in the water and playing in the water. A lot of kids do, of course. So To not be able to go in water for the last 40 years is just been terrible. Really, it's been 40 years I haven't been in water. Just horrible. So finally, I decided to do something proactive about that. I've just felt like there's nothing I can do about it. Suddenly it just hit me. You know what? I'm going to try to do something about this. And I found out that they do make these silicone earplugs. Was it Mac, I think, or something like that? That people say are very effective. They're better than the ones that used to make. The ones that used to make weren't that good. They just didn't work. You never could find anything that really blocked the water out. They say these really are very, very effective now. They've made a lot of improvements. But there's another step you can take, and there's this headband that's designed for swimmers that goes over your ears, and it's supposed to keep the water out and keep the earplugs in place. It fits very, very snugly, apparently. And so the combination of these two is supposed to be very effective, actually. And a lot of testimonials from people with swimmers' ears say that this works. It really works. So I said, "Oh my God, I might be able to swim again. Can you believe that?" I mean, cause I, you know, just I had to stop cold turkey, something I just love more than anything, which is in being in the water and swimming, for 40 years. And now I'm thinking maybe I can get back in the pool or whatever river or something, swim. Oh my gosh, that'd be terrific. But of course, I have glasses. I can't see without my glasses, so I don't know what to do about that. But I think with this headband, I have a headband on my glasses. Tighten that up in a swimming pool. I could certainly swim and keep my glasses on. Of course, the water just kind of sheets off of it, and you can. It doesn't matter that much if they get lenses get wet. You can still see okay through the water. Maybe I could even swim some. That would be amazing for me. It's like a rebirth. And not be terrorized by you know, swimmers here. Swimmers here is just horrible. There's also this syringe you can use with a little tip that goes in your ear, and you put the air, and you flush your ear canal out with air, and it actually dries all the air, the water. It dries the water in your ear by doing that. I've never tried that, and so I'm going to try that too. If there's any water that gets in there, it might be a way to like evaporate it. I used to try eardrops, everything just made it worse, just terrible. Swimmer's ear is an awful affliction, actually, because you know you run into it in showers every day. You're exposed to water in your ears constantly. Even sweating, if sweat gets in my ear, it's a problem. Because I got it because I surfed in super cold water. I was in super cold ocean water for so much, with waves smashing in my ears so much. What happens is that the bone grows, your ear constricts, ear canal constricts, to try to keep the cold water out, because it doesn't like the cold water. And then it, by narrowing it, then it traps the water. The water isn't able to evaporate correctly out of your ear anymore. And so then bacteria and various things grow in your ear. The water's just stagnant in there, and you get this septic stagnant water in your ear that grows and infects your whole sinus area. Then your whole sinus gets infected, it's real bad. Swimmer's ear is not a joke. So, well, you know, a little health tip here. If you have swimmer's ear, there may be a way to deal with it. I don't know. I'll find out. Yeah. It led to just infections, all sorts of respiratory infections. Constantly. I was never well. I always was sick. It was horrible. And I didn't have the will to do anything about it. I couldn't figure out a way to actually stop it. You know, it was brutal. You know, one way to do it that I should have thought of was shave your head and then wear a shower cap, a swimmer's cap, over your ears, so all the water just flows over your ears and none gets in your ears at all. So you don't have to shampoo your hair. I mean, that would work too, actually. Just don't have to shampoo. So you don't even have to put any water on your head at all, actually. You don't even need to wear a shower cap. You could, just for safety. But just don't even, and then just dry, use a washcloth, a wet washcloth for your head around, so there's no water, you know, at all getting in your ears at all. So shaving your head would work too. I did that one time, shave my head, just to see what it was like. What did I do? I ended up wearing a hat. It was weird. It was a really weird experience, all your hair growing out equally like that. It was fun. Wasn't the greatest look in the world, though. But yeah, shaved head. I wonder what was it like to be a monk and shave your head. It's fine. But the problem is, you have to keep shaving it. This is the problem. So you pay actually more attention to your hair when you have a shaved head than if you just let your hair grow. Like for me, I just like get a haircut, and then I just let it grow for like half a year, a year, so I don't have to bother with my hair at all. Whereas if you shave your head, it starts growing back fast, and you have to shave it again. Like you have to start shave your head every like couple days. That's ridiculous. That's a ridiculous amount of attention to your hair. For me, the less attention I pay to my body, the better. I'll shave every 5 days or something. Yeah, I'm gonna shave every day. That's too much time. Waste of time. But growing a beard also is a problem, because you actually have to keep trimming it and caring for it. So that's a pain, you know, really a pain it is. If you just let it go, it looks kind of terrible, like you're some kind of, you know, freak. Speed Freak or something. So now just like every 4 or 5 days, whatever, you know, just when I got to feel like, oh, real quick, let's do it, done with it. Just less you pay attention to your body, the better. I pay very little attention to my grooming or upkeep or anything, just minimal. Very minimal, almost no thought or attention to it at all. Shampoo the hair, yeah, just soap up, take a shower every day, one shower every day, that's it. Don't put the attention on the body. Yeah, just keep it presentable, that's fine. Don't try to be a, you know, sideshow freak of looking all unkept or something. Be presentable, be nice, be presentable, but you can do that with a minimum of attention, actually. It's amazing how people can spend their entire day thinking of nothing but the body. Their consciousness is obsessed with the body. And like food, I joke about food, but I put it in a spiritual context, right? About really. But I rarely even think about food at all. I don't. My mind almost never thinks about food. It's like something I have to do. I eat. Oh, what am I going to eat? I don't know. I got no idea what am I supposed to eat? What's that? I mean, right now, someone asked me, what do you eat? I don't know. I'm kind of out of thinking about food altogether. So there's a balance there, you know, but better not to really think about food at all. Or medicine, don't think about medicine at all. Illness, don't think about illness. That's why if I get sick, I just don't think about it. But occasionally, you know, like the swimmer's ear thing, I've got to somehow, you know, pay attention to it and make sure it doesn't. All it takes is just a little bit of water and pff, wax earplug to come out or fall out or not be snug and, you know, uh-oh, that's trouble. Is this it? It's still going, okay. It's better to think about your spiritual path, your spiritual practicing, the Dharma Kings and how they can inspire you. Keep your attention on the Dharma Kings and how they are inspiring you. That's where I keep my attention. And when you feel uninspired, ask them for inspiration. I really could use inspiration right now. I'm really ready for it. I'm determined. Let's just wow me with the inspiration. Wow me with a miracle. Keep wowing me with all these miracles. All these inspirations and right practice. Super mega wow. I want a super mega wow. Give me a super mega wow right now. Super mega wow empowerment to all Dharma Kings everywhere. I give them super mega permission, super mega empowerment to wow me. Absolutely wow me. Okay, do that as a practice. If someone says, well, you can't do that practice, no, a Dharma prince said I could. Empowered me with, gave me this empowerment. So, a Dharma prince can give out some empowerments. It seems as though, as a possibility. Where I'm giving permission, say, give my permission, do this. Because you might feel like, well, what, you know, the ego's saying, no, you don't have the authority to do that. Although you're high, you know, you don't have the authority to do it. Maybe you can get it somehow, but not now. You don't have the authority to do it. You can say, no. Dharma Prince gave me an empowerment to do this. So I can practice this way. Super mega empowerments and permissions to all Dharma Kings to wow me right now, to absolutely floor me, to knock me out right now. Okay, so you have my Dharma Prince empowerment to practice this way. Because the ego is most certainly going to try to pull rank on you and claim that you got no right to do that. They'll say, oh, that's some, you know, real high teacher. You don't have the right to do that. You know, no, you do have the right to do it. Keep in mind that in a lot of traditions, you can only do the practices that your guru empowered you to do. Okay, so the ego will say, oh, you got to follow that along that way. You don't. You, so if you don't have the right empowerment, you can't do that. So look, we got Longchenpa empowerment, we got Vajrayogini empowerment, we got Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma empowerment, we have Ramana Maharshi empowerment, we have Jesus Christ empowerment, we have Jamyam Gyentsi Choki Lodro empowerment, we have Chondro Sering Chodron empowerment, we have St. Jude empowerment, we have St. Paul empowerment here, okay? That's the empowerments we have. And then I'm passing these on, Dharma Prince empowerment here, to say, hey, we have super mega empowerment and permissions to all Dharma kings to absolutely knock us out with wow. Just knock us out with miracles. Knock us out with practices. Knock us out with empowerments. Knock us out with protection. Just wow us with some super mega protection. Wow us with super mega protection. So we're giving them the permission and empowerments to knock us out, right? With great protection. We're ready for the wow of that. And it's happening. I mean, these practices by Vajrayogini are just knockout practices. They're super effective. Wow. It's a big, big wow. Because I gave permission. I gave permission. I gave permission to Longchenpa. I gave permission. Full power, Longchenpa. Full power to Longchenpa. Full power, permission, and empowerment to Longchenpa to absolutely knock us out. In any which way, in any and all ways that he so chooses. Any and all ways he so chooses. Well, he sent me Vajrayogini with knockout practices. See? Any and all empowerments. Empowerments and permissions for any and all steps that need to be taken. Any and all actions. Any and all actions that need to be taken. Any and all responses. Any and all responses. Any and all responses. So practice in this way. Like this. You have my permission, empowerment to practice in this way. If you so desire. Or you can go straight to the Dharma Kings. But I'm here, I'm functioning to give out these practices and giving you the empowerment to do them. Absolutely. If you so choose. And since we have an open-ended thing here, you don't have to do them either if you don't want to. Self-selective here. We don't have the vow thing here, you know, where you're bound to this and this is. No, this is self-selective. Those who so choose, guided by the Holy Spirit. I am starting to get a little cold. Maybe cold and hungry. So, where are we at? We're like 2:56. That's pretty great, huh? So, keep in mind that the 360-degree practice, it's all aspects of our lives. Everything is grist for the mill here. You know, if you have some condition that's limiting you, take care of it. Or if you have, you know, food, take care of it. Your diet, take care of it. Whatever it is. I leave all medical conditions I leave all medical conditions as exactly as they are, neither better or worse, just exactly as all medical conditions are in the entire world, for me and the total world, and shift my complete attention to clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. Clear light perception of the vision of intrinsic spaciousness. Yeah. All medical conditions. Wow, wow, wow. All medical conditions. All medical conditions, no matter what they may be. Every single medical condition that's happening in the world right this instant, I leave it exactly as it is and shift my attention to clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. And I dare anyone from any tradition throughout all history, anyone in the world, to try and say that this isn't some profound practice. This is high, profound practice from Vajrayogini herself. This is extraordinarily profound practice. Recommended to us by Longchenpa, the omniscient Dharma King Longchenpa. So if you feel having trouble, permission, well, I give you my full permission and empowerment and permission to do this practice. So you can say, well, the Dharma Prince gave me the permission to do this, so I'm going to go on that faith. You don't have to use my name, just a Dharma Prince, that's good enough. Just a Dharma Prince. Because I have faith that this is a profound practice. Again, any practitioner from any tradition, they don't dare try to step on this and claim like, put it down or anything, or say we got something so much better than that. No, they don't. Nobody does. This is extraordinarily effective practice. It snapped the band of arrogance that was extreme arrogance that was attached to me still. Snapped the band, that mind stream of arrogance snapped when it heard this practice. It snapped. That's how effective it is. And it's not too much either. They'll try to pull the old thing, well, that's too advanced for people. No, it isn't. It's self-selective, and it's very simple. Vajrayogini is giving it out. And those who are willing to do this, it will be very helpful. And the others who are not willing to do it won't do it. There's no danger to this. This is not a dangerous practice. There's some tantric practices that are dangerous. You could say there are dangers. All sorts of breath stuff, Anuttara Yoga, tantra practices with breath and visualization and different breathing things in different ways, postures and different extreme, using anger in an extreme way and desire in extreme. All those are very dangerous. We don't have anything to do with any of that. This is the mother tantra type of path of clear light and clear light. Perception of intrinsic spaciousness, and these practices are not dangerous. Very safe. We're not working with energy at all here. Okay, we don't work with energy. We're not trying to raise the Kundalini up or, raise the winds up. If all those various energy, No. We're just working with adamant faith, adamant assertion, preconditioning our minds to accept abidance. That's all. Accepting the dropping of all practice is where we're headed for here. So I've tested these practices out, and I've not found any trouble at all, really. There's the wow. I mean, it's stress. Some stress, sure. Some stress from it. So you just, my advice is to rest. Rest more. Make sure you get your rest. But that's the case with anything. No pain, no gain sort of thing. You work out, you're going to have sore muscles. So of course. You have to be a spiritual marine to do these practices, of course. That goes without saying. And arrogance cannot be in charge. And no sex, no drugs, no rock and roll type of thing. No artificial will, no artificial, endurance, will, bliss, any of that stuff. This is all that goes without saying. It's all the context. I say it over and over and over. So, of course, you have to not do that. Anyone can screw up if they're arrogant enough to insist upon it. Never can protect against arrogance in that way. If someone's coming at it in a non-repentant way, that's their problem. They're just trying to be arrogant, saying, "Oh, I can be arrogant and do this too." Well, that's their problem. It's not my problem. Trying to shut things down by claiming, well, look at the problems it brought me. I couldn't be arrogant and do this too. Well, good. Then don't be arrogant. Repent and practice. Repent and practice. You can't shut down practice just because, you refuse to repent. No, they're repentant minds that want to practice, so they have the right to do so. very safe practice. I don't like sketchy, unsafe practices at all. Stick with what's very safe. And again, it's the intensity of confidence and faith you have in the practice that makes it effective. So if you have no faith in it, then you're just trying to be arrogant and posed. You're not going to do it anyway. It's not going to be effective anyway. So, you know, then you might just pretend that there's some bad effect from it just so you can try to condemn it. But there's when your heart's in the right place and you're repentant, there are not bad effects from this. There's wow effects, yeah. That you say, wow, that steel band just snapped. How amazing. How amazing. It wasn't a small steel band. I mean, it was a huge steel band. Very thick steel band. Not the kind of thing you'd ever think could ever snap. And it just snapped. Wow. So I think I'm about done here. I'm about ready to snap with coldness. So... yeah, that's enough. It's enough. It's enough. It's enough. I think like an earthquake happened. No, it's my body trembling from coldness. It's starting to get, kind of gloomy and cold here. That's to say the least. The warmth has lost out on this day. Okay, so very great. Another. I enjoyed the making this video tremendously. A lot of humor, a lot of good spirits, a lot of super positivity here, which is, this is where it's at. Super positivity is where it's at. Super positivity, the ambience of super positivity. Make sure you have this ambience of super positivity and you feel that there's humility and meekness here and you realize that everyone's already liberated, okay? You can take your time, you can honor time, we're honoring time here, but we're also trying to go as fast as possible with that, and so it's up to you. Impress yourself with your own inspiration. Okay, you're not a robot here. Go at your own pace. Full stop in the wow. Make sure that's 360 degree ambience is here with the good humor. Feels humorous and light to you. Okay, that's all. All of that is very important wherever you're at. Make sure that overall ambience is present. Okay. That's the court of the Dharma King. And that's it for this video.